way.
Oh, I considered myself then, and I consider myself now, to be a personal and political failure. How could it be otherwise? I've led the party, and we've been defeated twice. That's hardly a definition of success.
I owe this party every life chance I've had from the time I was a child.
Stop work and join it!
Be sure that you can convincingly justify the way that you vote. In the street, at work, wherever you go, justify it there! You can't play politics with people's jobs and with people's services. No such thing as society, just me and now. That's Margaret Thatcher's society. Now is the time for change. Now is the time for labor.
It was almost like being called up. There was no real alternative. What I believed in and wanted to thrive was in peril. And I had to do what I needed to do in order to try and defend it.
I therefore declare Neil Kinnock elected as leader of the Labour Party.
Here was a man who was tough, very, very, very tough, possibly the toughest leader the Labour Party has ever had.
His tragedy was that very often for the wrong reasons, reasons to do not with his intellectual capacity or anything of that sort, but very largely because of social snobbery, he was perceived as being unable in the end to reach out to that further swathe of voters that we needed to secure victory.
I think he squashed and strangled a lot of the attractive aspects of his character that are part of Neil. So he ended up with people no longer feeling those attractive things and not quite trusting the remaking of Neil Kinnock.
It's very strange that Neil Kinnock, who is, I should think, the great evangelist politician of this half century, presided over a Labour Party which was less interested in evangelism than it was in the graphs and the diagrams and the figures.
I think Neil is one of the tragic heroes of politics in my period, rather like Gorbachev in the Soviet Union. I mean, just as Gorbachev will always be remembered in history as the man with whom the Cold War would not have come to a peaceful end, Neil, I think, will be remembered in history as the man who set the Labour Party back on a path on which it would hope to win power.
All right, he didn't win an election and he didn't become Prime Minister, but that doesn't mean that his contribution was not absolutely vital. And I certainly feel, as the leader of the Labour Party, a great sense of gratitude for the work which Neil did and for the inheritance which I got, which is so much better than the one he got.
Neil took the Labour Party from a point where it looked as if it was going to go out of British politics altogether, and he brought it back to a confidence in itself and an ability to win and form a government. I think by a lot of personal courage and a sense of vision about what a modern Labour Party should look like, that will be an inspiration and an example to me and many others like me for the rest of our political lives.
That the day will come when with the Labour government the country will get better in its spirit, in its soul, in its fortune.
The story of Neil Kinnock and of how he devoted his life to transforming the Labour Party has its roots in Tredegar, in the heart of the South Wales mining valleys. Neil Kinnock was born here in 1942. His mother was a district nurse. Both his grandfathers had been coal miners. His father too worked in the mines and then in the giant Ebervale steel plant. An only child, it was from his parents that he was to inherit his unique mixture of charm and political ruthlessness.
My mother would believe the best of everyone, and then when she was let down, really freeze the relationship. Not go for vengeance, but freeze the relationship. Well, my father believed the worst of everyone, and when he was proved wrong, there was no more generous or loyal person on the face of the earth. And I sometimes reflect that I might be a combination of both of them.
Kinnock joined the Labour Party aged 15 and pursued his political career at Cardiff University, where he was president of the union. It was here that he first met Glenys Parry, whom he married 2 years later. By 1969, he was the secretary of his local Labour Party, Bedwellty, in South Wales.
I was sitting there taking the minutes when, under any other business, the then Member of Parliament, a nice old chap called Harold Finch, said, yes, I've got a bit of any other business. And I was just closing my minutes book, you know, the meeting was over. And Harold Finch said, well, I'm not going to fight the next election. I'm not going to be the candidate in the next election. And my pencil snapped. So I went with my friend down to the Llanarf Club in Pontland Drive, and we had a pint, and I said, right, what do we do, boys? Who are we going to put up? And they said, well, you bloody idiot, you are the man that we're going to put up. And that's how I started running to gain the selection in 1969.
Put up he was, but as the youngest and least experienced of the candidates, the chances of being selected looked very slim.
On the day on which I was selected as the candidate for this constituency, June the 6th, 1969, I came up here in order to write the speech that I was going to give to the selection conference. I knew that I'd have solitude and complete quiet. It was a glorious afternoon. And so I did my scribbling up here. And I remember as I left this mound, which is a pre-Roman fortress, I remember thinking, the next time I come here, I'll know whether I'm going to be a Member of Parliament or not. And so the next day, which was a glorious summer's day, in the afternoon, after I'd seen all my family, I came up here with Glenys, and we looked out over the valley, and then we went for a drink in the Church Inn, just on the other side of St. Judas Church here. So it's a special place for many reasons, but that's probably chief among them.
The selection meeting was to be the first time that Kinnock the speechmaker stole the day. Tied at 75 votes each with the rival candidate, he had to face the selectors once again.
They had to come back in to speak again. And of course, the other candidates weren't as able as he was to make a difference and new speech, because they had prepared texts, I think. So he came in with a fresh speech and a fresh appeal, you know, to them for the candidature, and he got it by a whisker.
By 76 votes to 74, Neil Kinnock was chosen as the Labour candidate, and on June the 18th, 1970, he was elected MP for Bedwellty.
The count was so exciting, because just to see, because I'd been involved in Anglesey Labour Party and I'd never seen votes piling up like they did that day in the Plaza Hall, and the floor was just being stacked up with Labour votes and with his name on them, and it was very, very thrilling.
I think I can probably remember every second of that day, because it really was a golden sunlit day, in many ways a perfect day, a day of success. But a day when the family were all together, and there was a sense of being on the lip of the rest of time. and it was an enthralling day.
What's more, he had a majority of 22,000. At the age of 28, Kinnock had inherited one of Labour's safest seats, a job for life if he wanted it, and a rock-solid platform from which to launch his political career. He came from the left. His views were clear and uncompromising.
The function that the Labour Party set itself, I think, is to ameliorate capitalism. I think it succeeded to a very great extent in doing this, and this is probably one of the reasons why it seems to have lost its sense of purpose. But really and truly, there's only one very short answer to can you have socialism in a capitalist, in a market economy, and the answer is no. There are far too many paradoxes, far too many confusions, and too many arguments.
I first heard of Neil Kinnock when George Thomas, then Shadow Secretary for Wales, referred to this person, who I couldn't identify, as having opinions as red as his hair. Clearly he had more hair in those days. The red hair went all the way across. And I think the red opinions went all the way across as well, back in 1970 or whenever it was.
He looked bright, golden-haired, full of vigour, full of zest. His way of speaking, he spoke beautifully, he used the language beautifully. His energy, all these things made him stand out.
We seem to share the same interests on most subjects. He represented the mining constituency, as I did, and he seemed to say all the right things. The only difference was between us at the very early part was that I used to go to Parliament every day, and he seemed to think it was better to go around the country preaching left-wing socialism, and he thought that was more important.
This preaching took Kinnock across the country. He covered thousands of miles to address hundreds of meetings of local parties and trade unions. The Kinnock-Skinner comparison was a telling one. Both were men of the left, but Kinnock from the outset was determined to build for himself a power base with the party's rank and file. With his quick wit and powerful speaking style, he soon became the left's rising star.
I think that the time that I've most enjoyed being involved in politics as a professional, as an MP, in fact, the only time I've really enjoyed was around about 75, 76. There was a lot going on. We had a Labour government. You could get things done at the constituency level. The family was growing up. We were all together. And all in all, my life was very satisfactory and very fulfilling. I was starting to write a bit. I was getting some public notice, and it wasn't that I got an ego boost from that, but it did justify my existence.
It also brought him to the attention of senior figures in the Labour government. Some asked him to become their parliamentary private secretary, but wanting to preserve his freedom to work outside Parliament, he turned for help to his old friend Michael Foot.
So I came up with this great wheeze that I would say, "No, I'm sorry, I'd love to be your PPS, but I can't be because I've already agreed to be Michael Foot's PPS." So I saw him, and he said, "Well, I don't really want a PPS." And I said, "Well, I don't want to be a PPS." I said, "But it'd make my life a bit easier." "All right, then," he said. And I said, "Well, I'd do it for a year." And he said, "Well, yes. Well, okay, yeah, I'm very glad if you'll do it, but I don't see why people have them."
By 1977, Kinnock could see that the government was running into economic trouble. He was quick to attack Jim Callaghan's cuts in public spending. The rebel was now the hero of the party conference.
Madam Chairperson, Neil Kinnock, Member of Parliament for Bedwestry. Only action is going to get us out of this. And if you take a page from the book of the TUC, if you look at Harry Irwin's speech in the TUC, if you see that £3,000 million worth of reflation now, we're not asking you to let it rip. We just want you to tear it a bit. Tear it a bit for production. Tear it a bit to fight unemployment. Tear it a bit to win the next election, and do it now.
He wasn't courting the party establishment, but he was nonetheless becoming increasingly prominent. His boycott of the Queen's speech in 1977, when he sat alone in the Commons chamber with Dennis Skinner, was conveniently captured on camera. Too conveniently, thought some.
In 1977, Neil spotted me on the bench, sat there on my own, and he said, "What do you do here?" I said, "I sit here and wait till they've finished." I says, I don't recognise the House of Lords. It's undemocratic, it's elitist, it's based on patronage, and I don't want anything to do with it." And he said, "Well, I share those views," and he sat with me. And I thought, it's very odd, I've been doing this for 7 years, and this is the first occasion when he's joined me. And the following day, I saw a big spread photograph in the Daily Express. And I just wondered, I thought, it's very odd, I've been sat there on my own for 7 years, that Daily Express has not cared tuppence. When Neil joins me, somehow or other, they managed to get a photo. It didn't do him any harm at the time.
The following year, Kinnock got onto the National Executive Committee, the party's ruling body. He'd been elected by the party activists whose meetings he'd so assiduously attended.
Madam Chairman, comrades, first of all, thanks very much for one thing and another.
In his mid-30s, Neil Kinnock had established himself as a leading MP with a power base amongst the rank and file. But if his star was in the ascendant, the same could not be said of the Labour government's. By 1979, the government's credibility was in tatters. Disagreements with the trade unions had led to the winter of discontent. Jim Callaghan had to go to the country in the worst possible circumstances. Not surprisingly, Labour lost.
I still believe that we might hang on until the great dispute with the trade unions. But once there were bodies unburied in Liverpool and refuse uncleared in London squares and water pipes frozen in Lancashire and trade unionists refusing to unfreeze them, well, that was the end of the Labour government.
Where there is doubt, may we bring faith, and where there is despair, may we bring hope.
I thought Margaret Thatcher was going to get away with murder. I spent a lot of time in the late 70s after she became leader of the Conservative Party looking at the material that she and Keith Joseph and others like them were producing. It terrified me. I thought it was simplistic, banal indeed.
Kinnock was preparing to make his peace with the right of the party, but the rest of the left wanted revenge. They felt betrayed by the long years of Wilson and Callaghan compromise, ending as that era did in public spending cuts and war with the trade unions.
That manifesto was a profound disappointment to the mass of our party.
If we're going to have real influence from the rank and file, the grassroots of this party, then undoubtedly we all have to have a say.
That what he is doing today is swimming against the tide of history.
We saw two Labour governments elected in 64 and 74. They both failed, were both booted out by the electorate. They didn't create the great institutions that the Attlee government did in terms of the post-war period in a welfare state and full employment. People were looking to make changes so that, the leader was elected by the whole party. MPs didn't have the job for life. We wanted to make structural changes so that we wouldn't ever be betrayed by a Labour government again.
So began a bitterly fought war over who should control the party, the parliamentary leadership or the rank and file. Neil Kinnock started out firmly on the side of the rank and file, supporting their drive to rewrite the party's constitution. The left got its way. MPs would have to face re-selection at the hands of party activists, and the leader would be elected not just by MPs, but by the whole party.
The emancipation, the real liberty, the liberation of the British people.
As far as the constitutional changes are concerned, I had a lot of sympathy with those. In fact, I was a participant because I really did believe that there was a need for a more formal mechanism of accountability. And I thought it was self-evidently democratic.
Kinnock could also see that giving party activists and trade unions a say in choosing the party's leader would boost the chances of an MP from the left getting elected. Others had spotted this too.
I particularly remember the expression on his face when the vote was taken that we should move away from an exclusive franchise for members of parliament and in favour of an electoral college. And I remember thinking at the time, he thinks that's a big opportunity for him. It's the first time I'd really seen him as a leadership challenger.
Kinnock had backed all the key constitutional changes, but he was now tiring of the left zeal for internal party reform.
I would condemn them for not realizing much, much more quickly than they did that whilst purification might have been an acceptable course for in the religious grouping, For a serious political party, it should have taken 15th place or 20th or 1,000th place behind the main task of tackling the Tory government.
Whilst the Labour Party was fighting its own battles, Margaret Thatcher's government pressed on with its radical programme.
I have only one thing to say. You turn if you want to. The ladies, not for turning.
On economic policy, trade union law and privatisation, they challenged everything the Labour Party stood for. Kinnock felt the battle against Thatcherism should come before the left's quest for internal reform. So he took a job as Jim Callaghan's education spokesman. It was his first breach with the left, early evidence of the overriding pragmatism that was to mark his leadership years.
I accepted the position immediately because I'd realised in the previous couple of days that if I was asked to go on the front bench in any capacity, that it really was put up or shut up time, that we were going to have to fight, that we were going to be faced with a very right-wing government.
I affirm the independence of the parliamentary party and of the Labour government. At the end of the day, they must take the decisions. They are responsible. They have the responsibility.
In 1980, Jim Callaghan, exhausted, announced his resignation as party leader, opening the way for the election of Kinnock's closest friend and ally in Parliament, Michael Foot. Foot and Kinnock had neighbouring constituencies in South Wales. They shared a common political hero in Nye Bevan and had known each other since the 1960s.
I met him in Tredegar, and we used to go with several of his mining friends on walks over the weekends across the mountains outside Tredegar, the same mountains where Nye Bevan had walked and where others do, and I started arguing with him then. I think the very first person who ever suggested that Neil Kinnock might become the leader of the party or the Prime Minister of the country was Jill, my wife. She heard the arguments and saw him arguing and said, well, yes, he's the one for it.
I think Michael Foot, in a way, saw Neil Kinnock as the son he never had. He didn't have children. He loved Neil. I think there's no two ways about it, because Neil he saw as carrying on the tradition of the Labour Party in Michael's terms.
But Kinnock didn't want his friend Michael Foot to stand for leader.
And I said to him, well, you know my view of you running. I don't think you're going to win. I'm not in favour of you running. But since you are in, I'll fight like hell for you, which I did. And, of course, the guy won.
Beating the right-wing's candidate, Dennis Healy, the party was now leaning more heavily to the left.
I was delighted. I was ecstatic. And I made absolutely no bones about it. I was unrestrained in my response. I think mainly because my dear friend had won a contest in which he was engaged, and I really do like winning, and I like my friends winning.
Through a combination of political skill and good fortune, and after just 10 years in the Commons, Kinnock was a front bench spokesman, a favourite with a rank and file, and now Michael Foot was party leader. Neil Kinnock's own prospects were bright, but for his party, a year of civil war was looming.
We're just having coffee.
Well, we finally found a house, Mum, and it's all going ahead.
That's marvellous,
yeah. Who's the man who wants to call me a capitalist homeowner getting his mortgage?
Very funny. Abbey National.
Heavens, no, not them.
What? You've been an Abbey customer for years.
Precisely. They've been good to me. I've known in the local branch. They might find out we are related.
Your son's a responsible adult now, don't forget.
Responsible for turning my hair grey. There are other mortgage lenders, you know.
So? Abbey, you've been voted the best overall lender for the last 2 years by these guys.
Girlies galore.
Hardly.
I think it's very sensible. A mortgage is a long-term thing. Like having children.
Not the least like having children. When did our mortgage bash the car, or throw up a next-door garden, or flood the bathroom? When did our mortgage lose my passport?
Abbey National, the habit of a lifetime.
Being a stranger in an unfamiliar town might spoil your enjoyment of McEwen's Ladder. Let's hear it for trains.
What goes better with an intense snack than intense film? Eat this, watch this. Louis Kickett. Stealing my pot, I'd wrestled him for it. Connie, let's hit the mat. If this isn't snacking at its most intense, the devil don't scuba dive. Stay hungry.
Insurance company to a friend.
Is that what you're paying? You know who you should call.
Well, each year, hundreds of thousands of satisfied customers recommend Direct Line.
If you claim that you could not afford motor insurance, I can only say...
Direct Line Insurance. We come highly recommended. Call 061-839-2468.
The words fight, fight, fight have been used. I don't want to fight anybody in our own party. I don't want to fight anybody in our own party, I repeat.
Following Michael Foot's election as Labour leader, the party pressed the self-destruct button.
At that time, Glenys said to me, can anybody really lead this party? And I think that in the months, indeed the years that followed, the question was asked many times, if someone with the passion and the affection of Michael Foot couldn't command sensible, strategic support throughout the party, who could?
1981 began badly, with the Wembley Conference called to finalise the details of the new electoral college. The left scored a hollow victory in securing the formula most likely to elect a left-wing leader. Labour's divisions were laid bare for all to see.
At that time, neither I nor anybody else really could have anticipated that out of that special conference in Wembley would come the development of an alternative party. And that the Labour Party, those remaining in the Labour Party, would themselves split, and we would give the impression for 2 years after that that we were concerned about ourselves almost to the exclusion of concern about anything else.
Option four.
For many on the right of the party, Wembley was the final straw.
The day this system is used to elect a prime minister, the whole of the country will be watching the procedures. Why change for a system now, which you know will split the party?
When you have a position of this sort, where every aspect of the program was completely against what I regard as sensible social democratic politics, and what I'd stood for in government and opposition, as I say, then I thought it was not possible to remain in the Labour Party.
The formation of the SDP took away a whole portion of Labour's right wing, pushing the party's centre of gravity further to the left. It also compromised those on the right who stayed behind.
There was never any question of me being a defector.
But people like me who wanted to modernise the Labour Party knew that the spectre of defection was hanging over us, and people were ready to accuse us of being on our way out.
We have not yet really changed the structure of power in our society and what we are allowed to do.
Labour's divisions were compounded further when Tony Benn challenged Dennis Healey for deputy leadership of the party.
I was in the tea room in the House of Commons in the small hours, and I heard, as I passed one of the tables, Labour MP saying that Tony Benn had said that he was going to fight Dennis Healey for the deputy leadership. My feelings ran from really bitter anger right through to contempt, because the last thing we needed was a contest for a leadership position in the Labour Party, and everybody knew that.
But with the momentum behind them, the Benn camp pressed on, believing they could reshape the party.
And we'd like to keep them on their toes like we didn't before.
As Benn's support grew, he looked set to oust Healey. Kinnock, increasingly concerned about the harm the contest was doing to the party, resolved to act. He now chose to make his final and decisive break with the left.
I became increasingly determined that not only was I not going to vote for Tony Benn for deputy leader, but because of the way in which the contest had been provoked, I was going to do my very best to stop him being deputy leader. So I started writing an article for Tribune, and we went away with the family to Italy for holidays. And while the kids played in the pool at these apartments that we were staying in, I wrote the article.
As the party gathered for its autumn conference, it became clear that up to 30 left-wing MPs had decided to follow Kinnock's lead and refused to back Benn. The result was too close to call.
I knew, like everyone else knew, it was going to be a very close-run thing between Dennis and Tony. But as it became apparent that it was very close, I could feel the tension arising in me. I could feel my whole self tightening. I don't remember looking down to see if my knuckles were white, but I know that my whole body felt as if they were.
Tony Benn, 49.574. Dennis Healey, 50.426.
And the extraordinary thing, Tony being alphabetically first, his result was read out, and it was 49 point something, and it didn't appear to occur to the conference for seconds that simply because there wasn't a 50 after his name, he hadn't won. In those moments, what I knew was that if I'd had my time again, I would have voted for Dennis Healey, just to try and make it that much more certain.
Neil Kinnock's abstention in the deputy leadership contest was absolutely decisive. Not only did that determine the outcome, him and the handful that did that, but he provided a legitimate cover. And nobody else amongst the abstainers had the left credibility to actually do it and get away with it.
More importantly, Kinnock had shown a middle way between Benn and Healey, a path the party would soon follow. But in the process, he had alienated many of the party faithful. His NEC vote fell sharply that year, and he came under bitter attacks from former comrades like Arthur Scargill.
Well, first of all, what I should say is that 15, I think that the left-wing MPs, or those who claim to be left-wing, actually betrayed, not merely their supporters, but the fight that's taken place over many years. And the abstention tactic was really a dishonest tactic. In essence, it gave a vote to Dennis Healey.
I won't take it from anyone that when I make a decision about what is best in my view, democratic view, for the party and pursue that course, that I'm being dishonest. The fact is that it wasn't Tony Benn that lost the deputy leadership election yesterday. Tony was a really credible candidate just a year or so ago, and I supported him last year in the shadow cabinet election. If anybody lost in that deputy leadership election yesterday, it was you, the attitudes you espoused, and the people like you who espoused them. We're not having them in the Labour Party, mate. We want to beat the Tories.
In 1981, this seemed a long way off.
You have to be dead for a long time in the Labour Party before nobody attacks you, don't you?
Michael Foot remained unable to reconcile the warring wings of the party.
And believe me, I'm not dead yet. I'm here for a long, long time to come.
On the NEC, Kinnock was a witness to the constant arguments that raged between left and right. It was something he wouldn't tolerate when he became leader.
The National Executive Committee meetings were purgatory. There were people on that National Executive Committee who appeared to be bent consciously on humbling Michael Foot, of taking a course that was calculated to make him look ignominious.
An executive of a party ought to be a body that gives the orders and the arrangements, makes the arrangements to fight the enemy. And what some people had transformed the executive into was something quite different. That was a kind of parliament, if you like, a new parliament of the Labour Party, which had all its discussions in public. That wasn't an executive, that was a parody of an executive. It had to be changed.
Foot, struggling with his party, was also ripped apart by a hostile press. Kinnock could only look on.
I'd open the papers sometimes and see the way in which they were representing Michael Foot, and I would feel angry despair. If I had known what my friend was going to go through, I would have not only advised him that he shouldn't stand, I would have actively sought to resist him putting his name forward, because nobody should have to go through that. All the insults, disgusting insults, by lesser people, cowards. I don't think he should have been subjected to that.
Margaret Thatcher's government, in contrast, was winning back support. An emphatic victory in the Falklands War had made her a national hero. And economically, too, there appeared to be better times ahead. The pressures on Labour mounted, and rumours abounded that Foot would go. Senior Labour figures recall that even Kinnock might have been considering a leadership change, a charge that he denies.
There were some stories that the ideal ticket would be me as leader and Neil as deputy leader. And he very much surprised me once by asking if he could come and have a private chat with me. And I wondered what it was about, and maybe it was about this. And he came along to my office in the little cell block in which the shadow cabinet lives in Parliament. And he just really sat there. I was really very unclear why he'd asked to come and see me, whether perhaps he thought I would raise it with him.
But there was no time for change. In 1983, Margaret Thatcher called the election, offering more radical policies and a vision of the future. Labour's programme, long and incoherent, was a blueprint for failure.
No bills going up than pretty well any election they can remember for quite a long time past.
The 83 election campaign was pitiful. I was going to say a modern political campaign, but we wouldn't have run a campaign like that in 1950, let alone 1964. And just for me, for instance, I was supposed to be one of the leading speakers, like other members of the shadow cabinet. I drove myself around. I therefore had the full obligation for getting to places on time. I rarely had a microphone. I completely lost my voice. My larynx seized up. All of the process of trying to get press releases out and so on was completely confused. The morning strategy meetings were so bad that I just stopped going. It was better for me to get on the trail.
And I remember coming down from Manchester one Sunday morning to attend a meeting of this committee in the boardroom at Transport House, to find absolutely dozens of people there. Indeed, I believe that had it been raining, people who came, who wanted to shelter from the rain, might well have got into the meeting and taken a part in deciding our strategy, except that there was no strategy.
Labour failed to realise the impact that television would have on the campaign. Where the Conservatives, led by Margaret Thatcher, were slick and professional, Labour was simply bedraggled.
Oi! There
we
are.
We would have Mrs. Thatcher, her programme lined up. She'd have her speech made, or whatever she was wanting to say that day, in the can, and she'd be back in Downing Street most nights by 8:30. Poor Michael Foot would come staggering in some hall in Merthyr Tydfil at about 5 to 10 and have to go out live on the 10 o'clock news, regardless of what he happened to be saying at the moment.
I was very determined, as I think a lot of other people were, as a consequence of that experience, that whatever else we did at a future general election campaign, it would never, ever be like that again.
Kinnock had been Labour's strongest campaigner.
Got the bomb, now we pull out it. The youngsters don't listen to us.
But as the election drew near, even he seemed to concede defeat.
Margaret Thatcher wins on Thursday. I warn you not to be ordinary. I warn you not to be young. I warn you not to fall ill. And I warn you not to grow old.
By election night, it was clear that Kinnock's warning had been ignored. Labour were all but annihilated. Their share of the vote dropped below 30%, the worst performance for more than 50 years. Labour were reduced to a rump of just over 200 MPs.
They were seats that nobody reasonably expected us to lose that were going. And I just kept on thinking to myself, where do we go from here? It was the question being addressed to me by interviewers when you chat in between the results coming in. And I had no good answer to it.
There he goes. Three Conservative wins so far. Are you expecting to be the next leader of the Labour Party?
Mr. Foote is the leader of the Labour Party, and until he makes a declaration to the contrary, then all speculation, I think, is somewhat foolhardy.
But in his heart, Kinnock felt he was the only man who could unite the shattered party.
What I believed in and wanted to thrive was in peril. And I had to do what I needed to do in order to try and defend it. And it just so happened that on that occasion, what I had to do to defend it was run for the leadership of the Labour Party. And I realized what an enormous pressure it would be on time and on the family, and particularly on Glenys. Or at least I thought I realized. I didn't really know. I didn't begin to imagine what it would be. But it was almost like being called up. There was no real alternative.
Neil fought a campaign which was 10 times better than mine. And Neil caught the mood of the Labour Party in 83. He was young, he was radical, he was a great orator. He was full of life and full of hope. And perhaps most important of all, he was uncontaminated by membership of the Labour government of 74 to 79.
It seemed that only a disaster could deny Kinnock the leadership. And it almost did. In July, he was driving back to London after a hard day's campaigning in South Wales.
I can remember everything so clearly. The car hit the reservation, bounced off the railing, came back across the road, and I can distinctly remember thinking, well, it'll be okay because I'm going to hit the bank. And I did hit the bank, but the bank was at such an angle that I shot up the bank, and so the police say, the car spun over in the air, and eventually, a long way on, came crashing down its rear end, splitting the petrol tank, and then rolling over a couple of times on the motorway. And the only gap that I could see was through the passenger window, so I unclipped my belt and dived out through the passenger window faster than I've ever moved in my life, because I could smell the petrol.
Kinnock, Neil, 71.272%.
Neil Kinnock had walked away unscathed. Nothing could stop him now.
3%. I therefore declare Neil Kinnock elected as leader of the Labour Party.
He had become party leader at 41. Kinnock was the acceptable face of the left. The election of Roy Hattersley as deputy leader completed the dream ticket, though from the outset the two men were to remain curiously incompatible.
He did this immensely generous thing. He came to the front and stood up. And if you see the pictures, you'll see that he caught hold of my hand and raised it.
As I went up, Gerald Corcoran said to me, hold his hand in the air. George Brown held Harold Wilson's hand in the air. And Harold always resented it because it gave the impression of a joint leadership.
Leaving policy and ideology aside, Neil Kinnock devoted his first speech as leader to a simple call for party unity.
What I hoped was, most of all, that people would so learn from the cataclysmic experience of that general election that they would never, never, never go back to the indiscipline and selfishness and introversion and indulgence of the years before 1983. Of course, perhaps I was hoping for too much.
Just remember, all times in all temptations, how you, each and every single one of you sitting in this hall, each and every Labour worker watching this conference, each and every Labour voter, yes, and some other ones as well, remember how you felt on that dreadful morning of June the 10th. Just remember how you felt then and think to yourselves, June the 9th, 1983, never, ever again will we experience that.
Next week, the miners' strike and militant. Neil Kinnock reveals how he took on his enemies within the Labour Party. That's episode 2 of Kinnock the Inside Story, next Sunday on ITV.
The way that you vote. In the street, at work, wherever you go, justify it there. Justify it there. You can't play politics with people's jobs and with people's services. No such thing as society, just me and now. That's Margaret Thatcher's society. Now is the time for change. Now is the time for Labour.
As Arthur Scargill was speaking in that debate, I knew that the television cameras would be on me. And I said to myself over and over again, don't bat an eyelid. Don't make any gestures. Don't move. Just listen to it. And as I listened to it, I heard Scargill saying that he wanted the commitment of the Labour Party. And I remember thinking, don't you understand yet? Or don't you want to understand that we can give all the commitment that we like? But without power, that's empty.
Neil, I am very happy that your parents were able to move out of slums. Don't you now turn your back on the thousands of Liverpool families who now have the chance to work down on the decent council house just by a Labour council.
I say to Neil Kinnock, you've got one lesson only to learn from Thatcher. Show us the same loyalty to Carcass that she's shown to their class.
I want a Labour government. I want a socialist government. But I will not betray the National Union of Mine Workers again.
Power seemed a long way off for Neil Kinnock in 1983. The party he had inherited was demoralized and divided. There seemed no way out.
Amongst regional organizers of the party and amongst MPs, shadow cabinet members, there was a feeling of real bleakness, of gloom. They accepted the idea that we retreated to our heartlands, that we could make no wider appeal. So the job to me was obvious. To do everything possible politically in policy terms and organizationally, in order to get the party to turn outward.
After Michael Foot, he brought to the leadership a sense of purpose and a determination to end Labour's infighting. His overriding thought was that success could only come through reuniting the party.
He came with a very clear agenda about sorting out the party, making the party electable in the sense of its organisation, its image, its performance. I think he came with far fewer ideas about policy. I think organisationally he was stupendously prepared. I think in terms of policy he wasn't so well prepared.
Kinnock wanted the party institutions to march in step. But while the shadow cabinet rallied round, Kinnock saw that his real problem lay with the NEC, the party's governing body, which he now believed to be irresponsible, divided, and too left-wing.
It was important to ensure that people of quality on the National Executive Committee, who conventionally voted against the leadership and spoke against the leadership, moved their opinion. There were people like Tom Sawyer and Michael Meacher and David Bluntkett, to whom I could make a direct appeal in the course of arguments in the National Executive Committee, and I think realistically hope that they would eventually come over and vote with me. And as the years passed, that's exactly what happened.
With a new leader being elected, I think it was very important that support should be given to him wherever possible. I didn't give it on every occasion, but wherever I believed that there was justification, I certainly was willing to give support to Neil.
McNeil would meet a lot of people and talk quite widely, but he'd meet we three and he'd talk to us about the NEC and we'd think what the issues were and how could we support him.
The critical support of these people was crucial to Kinnock's plan to unite the party. But progress was halted just 6 months into Kinnock's leadership. March 1984 saw the beginning of the miners' strike. Realizing what was in the air, Neil Kinnock had met Arthur Scargill, the NUM president, at the House of Commons a few months after he became leader. At that meeting, the two men appeared to see eye to eye.
When I talked to Arthur Scargill about it, we were as one in our view that a sensible way to approach it was to get people from the coal mining areas and to get them reasonable, respectable, decent men and their wives to go into the south of England, leafleting, explaining, expounding the case for the pits in the national interest.
Arthur talked and responded in positive terms. But I think fundamentally there was a distrust between Neil and Arthur. Neil felt that Scargill had his own political agenda, which was not about the industrial situation in the pits. And so in that sense, Neil and Scargill were on a collision course from the outset.
We've challenged the whole basic concept of this Conservative government's philosophy.
Scargill had a vision, and the vision was that the coal industry would expand, probably double in size if they won the strike, that it would certainly drag down the Thatcher government, it would defeat the this great citadel of capitalism, and I think he really believed that.
In March 1984, the National Coal Board announced that Cortonwood Colliery in Yorkshire was to close, the first in what Arthur Scargill called a hit list of 70 pits. A full-scale strike became inevitable, as area by area the miners came out, led by Yorkshire. But crucially, the Nottinghamshire miners refused to strike. The miners were split, and the issue which split them was the refusal by Scargill to hold a ballot of all miners on whether to strike. The issue dominated the dispute and marked the first great failure of Kinnock's leadership.
I'd assumed throughout that the special delegate conference called by the leadership of the National Union of Mine Workers for the Easter of 1984 would be asked to support a national secret ballot of all members of the NUM. I was in North Wales at the time, staying with Glenys's parents for the Easter break, and went to Mould in order to do a television interview with Alastair Burnett. I got to the studios and met delegates from the NUM in North Wales, leaving the studio, who told me that they'd just come back from the special conference and that there had been no vote on the question of the national ballot. And I knew at that moment, as I went into the television studios, that the efforts to save the coal mining industry would be hugely reduced in their effect.
Neil Kinnock now faced a clear choice. Privately, he believed that Arthur Scargill should have held a national ballot over the strike. But to call for one publicly was a high-risk strategy, given the party's commitment to the miners' cause. He chose to keep quiet.
My problem was, I was faced with a large number of people, including constituents, including friends, who had made enormous sacrifices, who I knew I would demoralize by saying, you must have a ballot. And so I left it. And I shall regret until my dying day that I left it.
We're intimidated by the past. The Labour leadership does not criticise miners when they're out on strike. The ghosts of 1926 were walking through the Shadow Cabinet Room. And our failure then was not failure of judgment. We knew what was right. It was sentimentality.
Comrades! Yes, get it off your chest now, because I'm going to put the case for coal no matter how loud anybody shouts. This country, this audience, is going to keep on hearing the case for coal.
But Kinnock's attempts to put the case for coal were undermined by his failure to insist on a ballot. To the watching public, he seemed weak and subordinate to Arthur Scargill.
Please understand it, and then use democracy to stop this government.
It gave the public an instruction in my so-called weakness, so-called prevarication, so-called subordination to trade unions. But in addition, of course, it in itself, with the picket scenes and the soup kitchens and all the rest of it, reinforced in the mind of waverers in the body politic the idea of Labour as outdated, as nothing more than a trade union support group, as being defenders or excusers of violence.
The worst industrial violence occurred when Arthur Scargill tried to use his pickets to close the Orgreave Coke depot.
I remember when we sent busloads of men up to Orgreave, for example. They went up there as if they were going to the beach. They had trainers and flimsy rubber shoes on, they had jeans, some of them had shorts, they had vests and shirts, no more than that. And here they were suddenly faced with this medieval army. Police covered in body armor, with batons, with horses charging at them. It was an extraordinary sight, and in the hours and days that followed Orgreave, I remember the miners' offices in South Wales, in Pontypridd, they were like a field hospital after a battle. I mean, there were just broken arms and broken legs and broken heads everywhere.
And I say again to those individuals, whoever they are, wherever they are, the violence has got to stop, and the violence has got to stop now.
But Kinnock's repeated condemnation of the violence carried little weight after his failure to criticize the strike from the outset. He could only watch as the strike wore on.
I think that things really touched bottom in the July, when I'd had hopes that we could make a contribution to securing an end to the strike. And I met three people. An overman and two miners. And I could talk very candidly to them and them to me. And they were people who had been out since the first day, and they were amongst the last people to go back. And they were people who knew absolutely in detail, without reservation, that the game was lost. But nothing would have induced them to go back to work. They felt that this was a final gesture that they had to make. And that was a searing experience. It was like talking to people who had agreed that they would die together. And that's not an exaggeration.
Once it became clear to Kinnock that the strike was unwinnable, his thoughts turned to damage limitation. When the strike collapsed, nobody must be able to pin the blame for its failure on Neil Kinnock.
It was important to me, not as an individual, but as leader of the Labour Party, that whatever else happened at the end of the strike, however long it took, then I would be in a position to show that I'd not subscribed in any way to the defeat of that strike, but I'd held the line and could therefore say, no, a lesson must be learned from the way in which this strike was started, undertaken, and led.
So Kinnock sought to walk a tightrope, neither condemning a strike he believed to be doomed, nor openly supporting it. One year after the strike began, the miners marched proudly back to work. No miners' jobs had been saved. No coal mines had been reprieved. The Conservatives were still entrenched in power. The strike had achieved nothing.
Neil was one of those people who knows that politics is a meaningless pursuit unless you aim at power and ultimately get it and you can carry out the things you believe in. And he was deeply embarrassed by the miners' strike, especially coming from a mining part of South Wales, his father and grandfather being miners. And he knew there was no chance at that time of swimming against the tide. But I remember him saying to me, I'm just waiting for the moment when I can say what I really think.
That moment was to come at the 1985 party conference.
The conference of 1985 had before it a motion from the National Union of Mine Workers calling for retrospective compensation to coal miners from the next Labour government. And that had to be debated. I was determined that we should oppose it from the National Executive Committee.
Kinnock believed that it would be electoral suicide for Labour to meet Scargill's demands. So he set his face against a policy he knew the electorate wouldn't buy.
But they were in the days when there wasn't a majority for me in the National Executive Committee, and I knew that following the long discussion, it really was a matter of one vote. If I was going to win, I had to get somebody to move their vote.
For many of the 29 members of the NEC, torn between their loyalty to the miners and their loyalty to Kinnock, it was an agonizing choice to have to make.
I remember that meeting extremely well, and in many ways it was the most difficult meeting of my time on the NEC and perhaps of my life.
Meetings of the National Executive Committee at that time were usually traumatic, and there usually was a drama because Neil is that sort of person. He evokes great support and great anger. And he himself was displaying all the characteristics which people became familiar with in terms of persuasion and bullying, of arm twisting and cajoling.
When it came to the vote, the first one to vote on the recorded motion was a fellow called Ambrose from Cosey, and it was pretty clear that Cosey had taken a decision to support the miners. So their representative voted, even though he was right-wing himself, he voted with us. And so the die was cast. I began to do the sums then, and I realised that since we had got a certain number, we were going to win by 15 to 14. But I'd included Michael Meacham.
It was an exceptionally difficult vote in which I felt torn apart. And as I remember it, I didn't actually make up my mind finally until the vote was actually being called.
As the vote started, I was sitting near to Michael Meacher, and I said, Michael, if this vote goes the wrong way, you can say goodbye to any prospect of a Labour government. And he said, you really mean that, don't you? And I said to him, I know it.
Kinnock sort of gestured to him, come on, Michael. And he changed his vote. And that was the key one. And that enabled the NEC to be able to say to conference, vote this resolution down.
Now Kinnock had the backing of his NEC.
What can Mr. Scargill expect from you today, Mr. Kinnock?
Good truth.
And now he was ready for a showdown with Scargill.
The miners were no more defeated than were their gallant forebears on the Somme. Lions led by donkeys. They should spend the rest of their lives atoning for that fault.
In the debate, tempers were running high as opponents and supporters of Scargill clashed on the conference floor.
I've heard reference this morning to lions being led by donkeys. Well, I'm an animal lover, and I'll tell you something, I prefer donkeys to jackals. I move 59.
Scargill made an impassioned plea for the Labour Party to back the miners.
11,000 miners were arrested in our dispute. 7,000 of our members were injured. 11 people died, including 4 on picket lines, as they struggled to save jobs and pits and communities. Those people suffered in that way, not because there were some mindless militants, but because they were carrying out the policy of the TUC, carrying out the policy of the Labour Party. I ask this party to give its commitment to them as they gave it to you.
I remember thinking, sitting there, don't you yet understand that we can give you all the emotional commitment, all the sentimental commitment, even the commitment of whatever material means we have at our disposal, but without us having power to determine policy so far as the future of the coal mining industry is concerned, that commitment is a decoration. It's almost self-indulgent. And if you don't understand that, you don't understand anything at all.
He built his speech around this thought, and quoting a miner from his own constituency, he savaged Scargill's handling of the strike.
We knew then, all the time, that of all the times to call a coal mining strike, the end of the winter is just about the point in the calendar least appropriate, he said. His words. And the fact, he said, that he was called without a ballot denied to the miners unity, and it denied to the miners the solidarity of so much of the rest of the trade union movement. To the question, how did this position arise? The man from the lodge in my constituency says, it arose because nobody really thought it out. As you vote, be sure that you can convincingly justify the way that you vote. Not here in the tight circles, the comfortable, warm circles of a Labour Party conference, but in the street, to your neighbours, at work, wherever you go, in interviews, justify it there, justify it there.
Neil Kinnock lost the vote, but he had finally stood up to the forces in the party that he believed were jeopardising Labour's chances of winning an election. But by his own confession, he had done it too late.
Thank you.
Persil Color is the only detergent endorsed by these big high street names. Because Persil Color can wash out stains without bleaching out colors. That's why.
Hello. I'm here to ask a member of the public to give us his impression of Mercury and their telephone company. Let's choose an ordinary Joe at random. Hello there. We've never met before, have we?
No, I don't think so.
So tell me, what is it about Mercury you find so terribly attractive?
Well, the introduction of competition into some markets can bring real customer benefits. That's what makes them like Virgin.
Yes, quite. And what do you think of Mercury's excellent pricing policy?
Well, since 1984, the cost of everyone's long-distance and international phone calls have come down by an average of 40%. Now, in the case of our company...
Yes, thank you.
When Virgin started flying...
Thank you!
...to America...
Goodbye! So remember, Mercury's about. So don't miss out.
An unfamiliar town might spoil your enjoyment of McEwen's Lager. Let's hear it for trains.
Jiff Micro Liquid, where are you?
Hey, I'm new Jiff Micro Liquid. Okay, I'm small, but I've got micro power. So you use less. That's why I clean as much as 1 litre of ordinary liquid, leaving a brighter shine. It's no wonder everyone's shouting, Jiff Micro Liquid, where are you?
He's the best. He outshines the rest.
Here's good old-fashioned value for the holidays. To hire a Fiesta for only £99.50 a week all in, call your nearest branch of TLS Range now.
Neil Kinnock had been slow to confront Arthur Scargill, but he was determined to tackle the militant tendency head-on. Militant was a Trotskyist group whose members had been active in the Labour Party since the early 1950s. They had captured Liverpool City Council and in 1984 were refusing to set a rate.
There will be a revolt by people who are saying that we're getting the lead now and we're going to support it. And Chairman, that revolt when it starts will be something that not even Baker, not even Thatcher can ignore. And Chairman, they will be victorious.
I'll never forget a meeting that I had together with Jack Cunningham, who was our chief environment spokesperson, with the leaders of the militant-dominated Liverpool City Council, which I convened in the Shadow Cabinet Room. And they came out with this exotic stream of, there's a miners' strike, and given the miners' strike and the direct confrontational stance by the Liverpool City Council and other councils will provoke the government into calling a general election, and so disaffected to the British people that the way will then be open to a Labour government. And they said this time and time and time again. And it was such a fantasy. I didn't know whether to laugh or to cry. Laugh at the idiocy of it, or cry at the idea that these people actually were in charge of a major city.
The militant leaders of Liverpool were a continual thorn in Kinnock's side. Their strategy of forcing confrontation with the government, even to the point of breaking the law, angered Kinnock. He felt they were damaging the party by boosting its extremist image. There were some people in Liverpool who stood up to Militant, and they were given a rough ride.
In the Labour Party, it became unbelievably bad. Meetings were so highly orchestrated that you would feel physically sick before you went to the meeting. You knew what it was going to be like. You knew that the verbal abuse was going to be heavy and extreme. Quite frequently, I and others would compare bruises after meetings and joke about it and help try and lighten the atmosphere by trying to laugh it off. But there's no getting away from how bad those meetings were.
Strength to strength in Liverpool, despite the national leadership, despite the trade union leadership, and despite the press and the poisoners in the media.
Kinnock had been looking for a chance to attack Militant for more than a year.
The chance landed in my lap. I was at Preston Railway Station and got the evening paper, the local evening paper, Northwest paper, and saw that Derek Hatton and the other Militant leadership of Liverpool were going to send out taxis with redundancy notices to the employees of the city, including teachers and social workers and all kinds of people. And I turned to the people with me and I said, I've got him. I've got them. This is where it ends, in this shambles.
Just look at that.
Using the jobs of council workers in the fight against government cuts was a fatal error of judgment by a Militant. It gave Kinnock the ammunition he was looking for. At the 1985 conference, he used it.
I'll tell you what happens with impossible promises. You start with far-fetched resolution. They are then pickled into a rigid dogma, a code. And you go through the years sticking to that, outdated, misplaced, irrelevant to the real need, and you end in the grotesque chaos of a Labour Council hiring taxis to scuttle around the city, handing out redundancy notices to its own workers.
Several things happened at the same time, and I can almost see them in a film sequence now. Hatton and others from Liverpool started leaping up and shouting at the top of their voices. Eric Heffer started walking from my left. As I was speaking, I could see him out of the corner of my eye, that he was going to try and bundle me. Well, simultaneously going through your head is, well, if he pushes me, then I'll stand my ground. But fortunately, he walked behind me and stormed off the platform.
I'm telling you, no matter how entertaining, how fulfilling the short-term egos, I'll tell you, and you listen, correct. I'm telling you, you can't play politics with people's jobs and with people's services.
He was the first leader, either trade union leader or political leader, to understand what was happening and to say it from a national platform. And the sense of relief, it was euphoric. And I reacted probably quite extremely. I was cheering and chatting with everybody else in the hall.
We were not surprised at all when 85 came that he took perhaps the most cowardly approach, really, where he was able to stand up on the platform with the protection of everything that was going on, make that sort of statement, and get sort of blazing headlines in all the newspapers for doing that. And I think that certainly that we were not surprised that was the way he approached it.
Kinnock's attack on Militant won him the respect of the media for a time, and for the public at large, his personal ratings rose overnight. Those who had been fighting Militant in Liverpool saw their chance. Jane Kennedy asked to see Kinnock right after the speech.
I rang people at home in Liverpool and said, I've got the chance to meet him, what shall I say? And they made it quite clear that I should use the brief time that I had to get into his ribs and say that although his speech was excellent, the party still had a long way to go. And so when I did meet him, I made it clear that people in Liverpool still expected more. He still hadn't done anything like enough.
Buoyed up by his success at the 1985 conference, Kinnock pressed on in his drive to destroy Militant. After a long inquiry, the militant leaders were summoned to Walworth Road to be tried by the NEC. Kinnock was determined to expel them from the party.
What I therefore had to say to my colleagues on the National Executive Committee, not all of whom were persuaded of the wisdom of our approach, was that they were going to have to sit it out to the bitter end. That they were going to have to see it through if we had to sit 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for a month, because this is something that we couldn't afford to be casual about.
The meetings, the quasi-judicial meetings to expel individual militants, were sometimes tragedy, sometimes farce. I suppose they were grand gingo, a combination of farce and tragedy. But it did the job. It broke the back of militants.
Despite their defiance, the militant leaders of Liverpool were expelled. Kinnock was on his way to achieving total control of the Labour Party. But when it really mattered, and with the country watching, he couldn't deliver. During the Westland crisis, his failings were all too apparent. The crisis began in January 1986 with the resignation from the cabinet of Michael Heseltine.
I have resigned from the cabinet and I will make a full statement later today.
He resigned over Margaret Thatcher's refusal to consider his proposals to rescue the ailing Westland helicopter firm. In a bid to discredit Michael Heseltine, a letter from the Attorney General had been leaked, but authorised by whom? The finger of blame seemed to point to the involvement of Number 10. Many believed that with a short and forensic speech, Neil Kinnock could deal Margaret Thatcher a mortal blow. But on the day of the Westland debate, he arrived early at the House of Commons. His speech was complete, but with 2 hours to spare, he couldn't resist adding and adding to it.
It made the speech too long. It made the start less incisive than it should have been. And it also meant that the Tory party, against the ropes, determined to disrupt me right from the first phrase, was given an extra opportunity, with the result that my experience was ignominious.
There was the basic duplicity of their public dispassion about the affairs of that company and their private partisanship in the bids that were being made for Heseltine. Allegations. Clearly, they hold a cavalier attitude towards dishonesty, which may explain the attitude of many of them.
No shouts about that. You're members of this house of dishonesty.
Order. I think the leader of the opposition would wish to withdraw any allegation of dishonesty.
On the big occasion, Neil Kinnock had been found wanting, much to Margaret Thatcher's relief.
People have said, how do you think the Prime Minister reacted to it all? I was sat just a few feet away from her. She was a person of immense composure, but I'm pretty certain you didn't have to be a sort of front bench psychologist to judge that she was very relieved not to have had a more formidable adversary.
It was a defeat in debate that was difficult to recover from, both in terms of my own reputation and in terms of the general standing of the party. And I haven't forgiven myself for that failing, and I doubt if I ever will.
His next chance to topple Margaret Thatcher would be at a general election. In 1986, Kinnock was already preparing. He decided to transform the image of the Labour Party.
The Labour Party rose, and all things associated with it came from a variety of sources. Some of it I'd seen, for instance, with the Swedish Social Democratic Party in 1973 when I went to their general election. And I'd seen them using high-quality art photographs for their posters. Very striking. Good quality. And then, of course, there was the presidential campaign in France, the Mitterrand campaign, which used color and light and music and flowers, and it lifted the people. It was the politics of audacity and of optimism.
And now, will you welcome, please, the man who's made our dreams come true, the next Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, Neil Kinnock!
Kinnock backed the appointment of former television producer Peter Mandelson as Labour's new Director of Communications. With his TV eye, Mandelson wrought the revolution his master wanted. He assembled a volunteer pool of ad men and image makers. Together, they reinvented Labour's image. Kinnock tossed roses into the cheering crowd, it seemed that the old, divided and extreme Labour Party had been put to rest. But it hadn't. The image overhaul had only succeeded in papering over the cracks. This was most brutally exposed 3 short months later, in February 1987, when Labour had to fight a by-election in Greenwich in South London.
Morning, ladies. Lovely to see you. Morning. Morning. Great morning. Wonderful. Lovely to see you.
The local party chose a left-wing candidate, Deirdre Wood, opening the door for a barrage of attacks on Labour's loony left reputation. As a result, Labour lost heavily to Rosie Barnes of the SDP.
Greenwich was a hugely important event because it did so much damage to the Labour Party. All the old mischiefs about the Labour Party came out, its unilateralism, its opposition to all the Thatcher reforms, the fact that it was really an unreconstructed Labour Party still. And as a result, Labour's voters walked away in hordes.
The changes of presentation under Peter Mandelson were brilliant. He was an enormous asset to the party. He thought very clearly, he had objectives, and he gave the Labour Party a whole new style and a whole new facade. But of course, it was a facade. You can't sell something that people don't want, however well you package it.
On issues like defence, nationalisation and trade union power, this was still the party of the early 80s. Kinnock had transformed presentation, but not policy.
There was a great deal of commitment to those policies in the Labour movement. And to try and change all of them simultaneously, or very significant ones, substantially, in the period leading up to the 1987 election, the years leading up, would have, in my view, fractured, shattered the movement.
As the 1987 manifesto was drawn up, Kinnock's senior allies saw no evidence that he was prepared to change these policies.
I always remember we had a meeting just before the 87 election in which he was the leader running to be Prime Minister, and he asked us our views on defence, and there was a big majority there against unilateralism. But Neil said, well, I don't care, it's the one issue I'm never going to change my position on, and I'm not going to have it discussed again.
...1987 was a year of rising economic confidence. Thatcher's new brand of popular capitalism promised lower taxes and the privatisation of public utilities. It seemed irresistible. In calling the election, she pledged more. Labour responded by pulling together and fighting a vigorous campaign, throwing the Tories off guard. For a time, it looked as if they were back in the frame.
Being conscious in elections of the Labour Party working together, as it doesn't do on too many other occasions. And in 87, after those years of turmoil, we were faced with a very uphill task. And it was the first time, having been leader by then of the Labour Party for nearly 4 years, that I could really be conscious of having a united party.
It really looked about 2 weeks into the campaign. We knew we'd seen off the Liberals. We knew they were going to come third. And it really looked as though we were on a roll. We were coming up. And we did think that we had a very good chance of cutting the Tory majority.
My ambition in my more optimistic moments was to get the Tory majority down to 30 or 40. I thought that was, given the information available, a possibility.
It was because there was no platform upon which they could stand.
But for all the professionalism and pizzazz of the campaign, Labour's unpopular policies shone through. The Tory Chancellor, Nigel Lawson, drove a coach and horses through Labour's tax plans, exposing their inconsistencies.
He had nothing planned, as I recall, for the last Saturday of the campaign, whereas Nigel Lawson went down to the West Country somewhere and launched a great attack on our tax plans. And as a consequence, Neil and Roy, and even to some degree myself, found ourselves saying very slightly different things over a period of 2 or 3 days, and that kept the issue alive and made it the dominant issue of the last few days.
During the day, everything went wrong on Labour's tax proposals, and different lines, different positions were put out by different parts of Labour's campaign team, including Neil. It was the worst moment of the 1987 election campaign.
Labour's policies had been tested and found to be wanting. On election night, Neil Kinnock watched helplessly as Margaret Thatcher stacked up another three-figure majority.
In the evening, I'd arranged for some daft idea that I was willing to be filmed watching the results coming in, which is an extraordinary thing for me to agree to. So I went to the house of my best friend, Barry Moore, now tragically dead, and we sat in front of the television and watched what was going to be a disaster in any case, and were filmed doing it.
No one must slack. You can have a marvellous party tonight.
Margaret Thatcher had won her third election in a row with a massive 102-seat majority. There was nothing for Labour to celebrate. They had gained a mere 21 seats, and in some areas, such as London, had actually lost some. For all his efforts, tackling his enemies within and transforming the party's image, Neil Kinnock had barely scratched Margaret Thatcher's majority. Labour's policies had been decisively rejected again.
It was a sad evening, but I was determined. In fact, I think I said to Barry, this is the last day of yesterday and the first day of tomorrow, or something of that nature, because I was just determined we shouldn't tread that trail again. Sadly, of course, we did.
Next week, in pursuit of power, Neil Kinnock rethinks his most fundamental beliefs and transforms what the Labour Party stands for.
Justify the way that you vote. In the street, at work, wherever you go, justify it there. Justify it there. You can't play politics with people's jobs and with people's services. No such thing as society, just me and now. That's Margaret Thatcher's society. Now is the time for change. Now is the time for Labour. Thank you.
frills are cheap. I can get the hair standing on the back of their necks. Easy. But that's not the way elections are won. That's not the way in which you mobilize a great grouping of the British people who want just, clean, fair, forward-looking, constructive government. You have to do something else. And if politics was only about excitement, well, it provides me with no difficulty whatsoever. It's the business of demonstrating that there's more to it than getting cheers. That's what requires the determination, the persistence, the patience, the discipline. And that's what you're asking a whole movement to do.
Defeat at the 1987 general election was a devastating blow for Neil Kinnock.
The new Conservative government will begin work next Wednesday with a 102-seat majority.
Despite the years of hard grind, the party he led had won barely 31% of the vote and gained only 20 more seats.
13.75 million people voted Conservative, the highest number in the party's history.
The Tories at Westminster were as strong as ever. And for five more years, Neil Kinnock would have to face a Tory government with an unassailable three-figure majority. Kinnock had been ready for defeat, but not for a repeat of 1983's electoral annihilation. From now on, he would subordinate everything to the pursuit of power. He was prepared to rethink his most fundamental beliefs, and he would demand that his party do the same.
The defeat of 87 cast a great shadow across him and across the Labour Party. The defeat grabbed the Labour Party and Neil by the throat, you know, and it said, you still haven't done it. At that moment, after the 87 defeat and through that awful year of 88, awful for him in many ways, I think he realised just how high the rest of this mountain was that he and the Labour Party had to climb.
Neil didn't want to hang around, being a perpetual leader of the opposition. He'd become leader of the Labour Party in order to lead the Labour Party to victory and to form a government. I think that the 87 result was a bitter personal disappointment to him. I think that he decided, this is it. I'm not going to hang around. I'm not going to go on leading a Labour Party that can't win elections or can only pick up 20 seats after a brilliant campaign. I'm going to change this party. I'm going to create what is inherently a new party which can win elections.
The first step was for Neil Kinnock to recognise that many of the policies that his party had campaigned on at the 1987 election were out of date and would have to go.
It was clear to me, as it was to many others, in the wake of our defeat in 1987, that one of the major reasons for our substantial defeat was the fact that some of our policies were completely unacceptable to sections of the British people that we had to persuade, that we had to win in order to win an election, and that therefore a major review of policy was essential. I take my full share of responsibility for the fact that in 1987, 3.5 years after I'd become leader of the party, we still had policies which were a source of disadvantage to us and were not accepted by the electorate as being appropriate to their lives or to their future.
If Kinnock saw that policy would have to change, it was his friend Tom Sawyer who suggested the means. Sawyer, like Kinnock, came from the left and had just become head of the crucial NEC Home Policy Committee.
We'd lost three dimes. We needed a change. We needed a symbol of change. And a symbol of change, we thought, was a comprehensive policy review. I went to see Neil and asked him what he thought, and he was very enthusiastic, thought it was a good idea. I remember talking to David Blunkett, I remember talking to Brian Gould, a few people who I would naturally network with on the NEC.
So on the 14th of September 1987, the party's governing body backed the idea of the policy review. Such a root and branch reappraisal had never been attempted by the Labour Party. Kinnock knew that the party in Parliament and the party in the country would have to be yoked together.
I had in mind this ambition I'd always had of meshing together leading parliamentary spokespeople, people from the shadow cabinet, and members of the National Executive Committee. And really, that's how the formula developed, so that the seven policy review teams, or policy review groups, as they were known, had joint conveners, one from the NEC side, as it were, and one from the shadow cabinet side. I wanted the process of policy review to be structured and managed, to have a direction, sense of purpose, very specific agenda. And in order to ensure that, I did two things. One was to stay in pretty frequent contact with some of the key individuals in policy review groups. And in addition, see that people working in my office were engaged as research support and drafters in all of the policy review groups.
It was Neil's review, and everything that happened in that review, he was, at the end of the day, the master of it. He knew what he wanted in the policy review, and he got more or less what he wanted in the policy review as well. So he was very much the man who made it work, for good or ill.
Kinnock began the policy review in November 1987, simply and graphically. He got the Shadow Communications Agency to prepare as stark an illustration of Labour's problems as possible.
Neil had asked several of us some months earlier to put together something we called Labour and Britain in the 1990s, which was about saying, look, this is where we are now, but this is where the country's going. This is how public opinion's changing. This is how the workforce is changing. All those basic kind of demographic, social facts that people needed to have in their mind at the outset of the policy review. We had this extraordinary joint meeting over at Transport House, the whole of the National Executive Committee, the whole of the Shadow Cabinet. Very intimidating, very powerful occasion.
My own role in the presentation was to organise it, to make sure that it was not only politically acceptable and sensitive in the way that it was presented, but also didn't pull any punctures. At the end of the day, I had to take the responsibility and take the rap for what was presented, and therefore I was rather nervous of it.
With good reason, the Mandelson-Hewitt presentation didn't pull its punches. Its central message was that Labour was out of touch with both society and with the electorate. For decades, Labour's share of the vote had been dropping. Within all classes, support for Labour had fallen away. While more and more people could look forward to all the benefits of rising affluence, to most people, Labour seemed hostile to individual prosperity, economically incompetent, extremist, and not to be trusted. Although Kinnock had started out a left-winger, the truth was that ideologically he travelled very light. He was, above all, a pragmatic politician. He now believed that to win power, he would have to ditch a range of policies his party held dear. To him, all this was just modernization. To others, it was betrayal. And in the spring of 1988, the left, in the form of Tony Benn and Eric Heffer, tried to stop Kinnock's retreat from socialism by launching a challenge to his leadership.
Fight for socialism! Socialism and democratic socialism is the only real answer to our problems. Let's mobilise the people of this country to go out and fight for it.
And soft left discontent was spearheaded by John Prescott, who also joined the deputy leadership contest. Frustrated at what he saw as his party's refusal to change, and impotent in the face of a massive Tory majority, Kinnock, by 1988, had grown weary of the job of Labour leader.
When I was Labour leader, there were occasions that were rewarding, enjoyable, fulfilling, but the general spread of the experience was pressurized, but I'm not particularly bothered about that, or about hard work. I like hard work. just was completely unsatisfying, frequently frustrating. It generated anger, partly because of the refusal in some quarters to try to understand what we were about. And all in all, not a pleasant experience. Not one that I'd be anxious to return to, no. 1988 was not an uplifting year. It was a year I've described as a stale year. We had lost the election, and the full effect of that was coming home. It was a year in which we were trying Labour listens. The policy review had just got off the ground. Nothing much appeared to be happening. There were a lot of press jibes about treading water, about being in a vacuum. Members of Parliament get together, they talk to each other, and if they talk to each other for long enough, they can usually talk themselves into a depression.
He would certainly become very depressed, and that depression would kind of sometimes turn itself into a feeling of, you know, I'm not sure this mob deserves me, really. I mean, I'm throwing everything into this great project to try and modernize this party. And look at this lot. You know, all they want to do is shoot me in the back.
By the summer of 1988, Kinnock wasn't just frustrated and depressed. His leadership was lifeless and was attacked by every newspaper.
Neil always read the newspapers. The press throughout his leadership was never forgiving. Many commentators often attacked his intellect, his lack of gravitas. And it's natural for those around him who respect him, who love him, to try and protect him from these articles. But that was never possible. He is an avid reader of newspapers, and you could never keep any articles from him. And they were deeply hurtful.
I know that Neil is to become enormously frustrated. He would rant for half an hour at a stretch sometimes when he, in private, about the fact that he had to spend all this time convincing Neanderthal trade union leaders and Neanderthal MPs that it was important maybe to reassess some of our policies and some of the ways in which we presented ourselves.
In the summer of 88, just before Parliament rose for the recess, no one could read a newspaper without seeing pieces written by journalists referring to a Kinnock must go movement that apparently was circulating around the terrace on the summer evenings and the tea room. And the only thing I could do about that was to just wait for it to become evident by somebody having the courage to come up to me and communicate this view, or come to my office, or just stop me in the lobby. And nobody ever did.
By the time of the autumn conference, Kinnock was ready to resign. If Prescott had beaten Hattersley, Kinnock would have gone.
To have defeated Roy Hattersley at that time would have been evidence of such a lack of seriousness in the Labour Party, such a lack of attention to the major tasks of confronting the government and reaching out to get more support for the Labour Party, that it would have made the party not worth leading. And fortunately, the party proved that it was mature, and Roy won by a very comfortable majority. But I certainly would have gone if Roy Hattersley had been defeated.
That autumn, Neil Kinnock and Roy Hattersley fought off their challengers. Tony Benn's 11% of the poll only served to emphasize how marginalized the Labour left under Kinnock had become. If anything, Neil Kinnock's position had been strengthened by the leadership contest. His job was safe. And now the party had no alternative but to back the Labour leader and to back him in his policy review.
I'd don't care what the weatherman says. When the weatherman says it's raining, you'll never hear me complaining. I'm certain sunshine. I don't care how the weather...
There is a new antiperspirant, Shawsense Eve with aloe vera.
It's got to be sunny to me.
It's tough on perspiration, but also gentle on the skin. Gentleness in a tough world.
Oh, gee, but...
New Shawsense Eve.
Gold filtered. Hey, this is really interesting. Coors backwards is Srook. Yeah, served cold, makes sense. Served date on the bottom.
Huh? Hey, John, have you read this one?
No, I haven't.
Get a life.
Yeah, Coors backwards is Srook.
It's still there.
Jif Micro Liquid, where are you?
Hey, I'm new Jif Micro Liquid. Okay, I'm small, but I've got micro power. So you use less. That's why I clean as much as 1 litre of ordinary liquid, leaving a brighter shine. It's no wonder everyone's shouting, Jif Micro Liquid, where are you?
He's the best. He outshines the rest.
Have you looked in the mirror recently? This week with the Sun Alliance, we'll pay off your mortgage up to £50,000. Five people must win £50,000 mortgages or £40,000 in cash.
Manager, we'll see you now, sir.
Tell very much.
Surprised? You will be. You'll be surprised when you look in the mirror.
Back in a minute, darling.
What is it with you adults? Well, you insist I drink this milk stuff every day. The only time I see you have it is in coffee. I mean, this stuff's delicious. Oh, I love it. And just look what great shape I'm in.
Whoa!
You know, I'm only 18 months and I'm already 2'6". I'll tell you, I think you adults must be a couple of blocks short of a building set. Oh, speaking of which.
Are you good little boysy-woysy? Gone and drunk all your milky-wilky.
Oh, now, come on. I mean, is that really the behaviour of a normal human being? It ain't just kid stuff.
Yes, sir. That's my baby. That's my Johnson's baby.
A Johnson's baby wouldn't dream of using any other lotion. Because a Johnson's baby knows there's no milder cleanser.
Yes,
Johnson's baby lotion leaves your skin clean and baby soft.
Johnson's baby now.
Shouldn't you be a Johnson's baby?
There you are. It's the Astra airbag demo, JD. I'm afraid they haven't delivered a dummy.
What? What? How can I proceed without a dummy?
JD! QE!
Sorry, I'm late. Not only do these Astra specials include sunroof, body-coloured mirrors and tinted glass, they also boast a full-size driver's airbag. Observe.
Well done, Atkins. Well done. Atkins? Atkins?
Only kidding, JD.
The Astra specials. California Diamond Cesaro Club.
And another Dez doorstep challenge. Here. I think we take this one as red, actually.
All his life, Neil Kinnock had been committed to scrapping Britain's nuclear weapons.
We are in a time of a weapon system that, unlike any that have ever gone before, there is no selectivity, there is no limitation, there is no inhibition of the effect of those weapons.
But now Kinnock believed it was a policy his party could no longer afford. What Britain should do with its bomb had bedeviled the Labour Party for decades. Since the early 60s, when Hugh Gaitskell vowed to reverse the unilateralist commitment, the party had fought its biggest battles over the bomb.
There are some of us, Mr. Chairman, who will fight and fight and fight again to save the party beloved.
In 1982, Labour, with Kinnock's support, had committed itself to unilateral nuclear disarmament.
The votes for 4,927,000.
But the party's unilateralism
had never been a vote winner. To Kinnock, it was now an electoral liability, and it would have to go.
However much the policy as it existed commended itself to us as activists and advocates over a period of 20 years, they simply were not accepted or acceptable to the great majority of our fellow citizens. And anybody who's serious about their politics has got to heed that basic fact of life. But I knew that this policy had an enormous significance amongst Labour Party members, and any effort to alter it would be suspected and would lead to breaches in the party and would make it much more difficult to secure change and progress in other spheres. So I had to bide my time.
I want a Labour Britain to play its full part in bringing about a nuclear-free world.
Kinnock began by appointing Gerald Kaufman to oversee the review of defence policy. Kaufman, a confirmed multilateralist, was determined to produce a new and clear line.
I remember when we were drafting the longest suicide note, that on defence a subcommittee was sent away to draft it, which included Dennis Healy and Eric Heffer. And they came back with a formula. And nobody dared interfere with that formula. What didn't occur to anybody was that a lovely little formula agreed between Dennis and Eric would have to meet the light of day. And it was like in Great Expectations when the curtains were opened in Miss Havisham's room. The moment the light came in, everything crumbled.
As Kaufman set about rewriting policy, Kinnock tried to prepare his party for change to come.
As it's tricky, I'd like us, if
it
we may...
It might be tricky for you, it's not tricky for me.
I'd like us, if we may, to agree on the premise that we're going to discuss it on.
The fact is now that it doesn't have to be something for nothing. The fact is now that it can be something for something.
It has been understood, perhaps misunderstood, that because you think the Labour Party is moving on, then it's moving on from unilateralism to multilateralism as a tactic and an approach.
No,
is that correct?
I put it very plainly. There is no need now for a something-for-nothing unilateralism. I can't be any plainer than that. It's very obvious.
There was uproar. The party's power brokers were astonished at Kinnock's attempted U-turn.
Frankly, I was amazed. I was amazed that Neil, who had always, like myself, been in CND almost from the beginning, and I joined CND in 1959, that suddenly the reasons were being expounded that I just couldn't reconcile with my understanding of what was going on. During the cold period of the Cold War, the real hard period, the Khrushchev and Brezhnev, we were arguing unilateral. And when we get to a position when Mikhail Gorbachev comes into power and is now taking fundamental reforms in Russia, and now we should start to say that we're going to use it as a bargaining counter. And I just couldn't reconcile that.
The party was not ready to renounce unilateralism, nor could Kinnock really afford to. He and his deputy were in the middle of a leadership contest. So at a lunch with journalists, he retreated and reverted to his former unilateralism.
I was faced with a dual task of trying to sustain the idea that our minds were more open, but simultaneously seeking to reassure the Labour Party that we weren't going to suddenly jettison a policy which many people in the party genuinely cherished. And the whole thing led to confusion. I took the blame for that.
At the 1988 party conference, Kinnock again sought to lay down a marker. His office made sure that conference had before it a motion advocating not just unilateral, but also multilateral disarmament.
What is the point of Britain making some isolated gesture when, with planning and foresight, we could also achieve a large reduction in the nuclear arsenal of the Warsaw Pact?
There's a song that we sing at Greenham Common. It's called, "Which Side Are We On?" Well, that's a question that we've all got to answer here today.
If we give an inch, it'll lead to a mile and another mile and another mile. Let's stop blaming the bum
and let's start banning the bomb. And I urge you to keep to our clear, concise, unequivocal policies. Then we'll have the people with us when we go out and fight and argue for those policies.
Kinnock hadn't yet found a way round the 1.2 million block vote of the Transport and General Workers Union, which was staunchly unilateralist. Defeat was inevitable.
Votes against, 3,277,000. So the vote is lost by 335,000 votes.
For Kinnock, it was a setback. But the majority for unilateralism had been the smallest for years.
I took some comfort out of the fact that that margin was small, that there was a possibility of continuing to work on opinion within the party and of reversing that margin by the following year.
By the spring of 1989, Gerald Kaufmann was ready to write his report. Kaufmann's document recommended that the next Labour government should retain the Trident missile system and include it in international negotiations. Kinnock immediately took to Kaufmann's multilateralist blueprint, and with the NEC due to vote on the new policy on May the 9th, the leader now set about building majority for a move to multilateralism. It was now to the pivotal soft left that he had to appeal.
In preparations for that key NEC meeting, Neil had very detailed discussions with colleagues such as Robin Cook, Claire Short, and others who were on the NEC, with a view to securing their support for the position that would actually be carried. That discussion included detailed discussions of wordings and amendments which would be considered by the NEC directly.
It was very tight on the NEC, the votes, so we had to listen to negotiations. We proposed this formula that we put Britain's weapons into multilateral talks, but that we guarantee to move into bilateral talks and therefore certainly to get rid of them if the multilateral talks fail. And we said if he would incorporate that, we would vote for it. And he said, okay, and he did, and we did, and it passed.
Neil had outmaneuvered those of us who thought that we were trying to hold to our policy whilst presenting it in common sense terms to the British people. And I really knew that the night before, because I went to Neil and I said, as I tried to do always with him, to be honest, I can't vote with you. And I could tell at that meeting that it didn't matter. The votes were already in the bag.
But Kinnock himself didn't think the votes were already in the bag. He knew he would have to explain to the NEC why he personally believed the policy had to change.
The future of the document was still very much in the balance. In fact, when we started that meeting, it would have been reasonable to assume that the proposals for change did not have a majority. So a great deal was left to the meeting itself.
The speech that Neil made was low-key, not hectoring, very honest, and very moving, and he just talked about his own journey and how he'd tried to go to Washington, he'd tried to sell the policy, it didn't work, he knew we had to change, and he did it with enormous dignity.
It wasn't just that people were against our policy of getting rid of all weapons and asking for nothing in exchange. They just didn't understand how any party hoping to become the government of the country could act in such a way in getting rid of what they saw as assets and not getting any gain, any advance, any extra security out of it. And on the basis of that understanding, I said, now I've done what others in this room have not done. I haven't just campaigned, been on the picket lines, been in the demonstrations, made the speeches, done all that, but many have. I've taken that campaign and those arguments to the Elysee and to the Kremlin and to the White House and on the doorstep. And I won't do it again.
But it was very powerful. And you think it, in fact, did something that speeches in bodies of this kind very rarely do. It did get a round of applause from the hard-bitten politicians who were sat around the table.
Kinnock had made his U-turn seem like an act of political heroism, and he got his way. David Blunkett's bid to set a timetable for the removal of Trident was defeated, 16 votes to 9 as the NEC backed the new defence formula. The next hurdle was the party itself, and conference that autumn. So now Kinnock set about building the coalition he needed. When he faced a unilateralist audience, he was explicit about the need for change.
In duty and in fraternity, I say to you, if our party was to go to the people of Britain, even after 10 or 12 years of Thatcherism, and say that now we were going to disarm without negotiation, or that we were going to obey a deadline, regardless of all other considerations, we would not get their support. That is the plain fact.
Kinnock couldn't win over the Transport and General Workers Union, but he didn't need to. In the summer of 1989, his closest ally delivered Newpey's 600,000-strong block vote.
Tom Sawyer, the Deputy General Secretary of the National Union of Public Employees, played an absolutely central role. He discussed the matter with his National Executive Committee. He argued the matter out, and he got endorsement so that his union, by the time we got to conference, was prepared to vote for the new defense document. And that, therefore, made it clear and clinched that we were going to win the vote on the document. And that's exactly how it happened.
By the time of the autumn conference, Kinnock had assembled a majority for change. The unilateralists were defeated, but defiant.
I heard an Aaron Bevan in Brighton 32 years ago today about his need to be clothed in the conference chamber. Heard him speak, spoke in the debate myself. We've never been invited to the top table in disarmament in that whole period. It doesn't give you a place at the conference table.
At 5 o'clock on Monday the 2nd of October, conference voted to back the new defence line. The party conference of 1989 went on to endorse all 7 reports of the policy review groups contained in Meet the Challenge. The document was long and dense, but its central message rang clear. Neil Kinnock's Labour Party was changing. It was now pro the bomb, committed to Europe, lukewarm on nationalisation, and perhaps most important of all, it was willing to acknowledge explicitly the strengths of the free market. If Kinnock was just following the Thatcherite agenda, it didn't seem to matter, because for the first time since he became leader, the tide was about to turn in Neil Kinnock's favour.
Interest rates go up to 15%, mortgages may follow.
By 1989, Mrs. Thatcher's economic miracle was out of control. Nigel Lawson tried to halt a surge in credit and inflation by pushing up the cost of borrowing.
To give up the principles in which he does believe. Won't it be even easier for him to give up the principles?
Margaret Thatcher, 10 years in power, was still able to ridicule Neil Kinnock's conversion to Thatcherism.
And it all happened as dear old Tommy Cooper used to say, just like that.
She was still queen of her party, but the crown was starting to slip. As interest rates went higher and higher in 1989, Neil Kinnock and his new moderate party threw everything into that summer's elections for the European Parliament, to breathtaking effect.
We decided to seize the opportunity of giving a real trial run to our campaigning techniques and systems that we would operate in the forthcoming general election. And so we had daily press conferences, very high quality material, very substantial campaign in the country, and as a result, an outstandingly good result.
It was Labour's first victory in a national election for 15 years, and one that left many commentators breathless.
There's the Speaker's chair, the opposition bench is there. And here we have the opposition parties building up, as forecast, if this were a general election, Mrs. Thatcher and the other various parties in Northern Ireland and so on, 312 altogether. There's the winning post, Mr. Kinnock's little red men and women need to reach if they're going to win an overall majority. Yes, they're through it, 338, 312. Not a general election, of course, but if it were, Labour would be back with a majority of 26.
We scored spectacular successes. We got 6 percentage points more in the share of the poll than the Conservatives. We won 13 seats. We won seats we didn't really expect to win. And there was great joy at that. Indeed, those hours that I spent in Walworth Road in Labour Party headquarters watching those results come in were the best hours of the 8.5 years that I spent as leader of the Labour Party. Because they were real votes in real ballot boxes. We fought a very positive and forward-looking campaign. We worked for our votes and we earned them. And the people, it appeared, understood the argument that we were making and voted for us.
Neil Kinnock now had an iron grip on the Labour Party, a dominance that no Labour leader had ever before achieved. Kinnock was brutal, ruthless, and authoritarian in his control of the party.
He had to manage everything, control everything, speak on everything, tell us all what to do. He sort of ceased to realise that a lot of us were pretty serious about the party too, and would, in a collaborative way, would like to contribute to those decisions rather than be forced to be loyal or disloyal on every single question, and never really asked what you thought or whether you had any good ideas.
Fiefdom, pure fiefdom. I mean, Neil used to meet quite clearly with the trade union section, tell them what the orders were, and then they went in to do it with the Praetorian Guard. So he always knew what the vote was going to be in the National Executive. It wasn't discussion, that was clear, and when I joined it, that was clear. Neil just run it like he'd run the Shadow Cabinet. Decided his view before and then really told them. There wasn't a great deal of discussion after that.
Well, I was elected to the NEC just after the 1987 election defeat. And I was on for 2 years. I have to say, I've never been on anything in my life which was so sustainedly poisonous, meeting after meeting after meeting. When you think that Neil Kinnock had a majority of about 24 to 4 or 5 on virtually every issue, it was fought as though it was a trench war. You came out of it absolutely drained. And the whole style was set by Neil. I mean, there was never any sort of thing, Churchill's line about in victory magnanimity. In victory, he then went on and pounded your face into the dirt with his boot. And it was bludgeon, bludgeon, bludgeon.
But in the spring of 1990, it seemed to be paying off. In May, Neil Kinnock set the seal on the policy review with the launch of the mini-manifesto Looking to the Future. Short and bland, it was nevertheless a revealing document. Kinnock had completed his revisionist project. The centrepiece of party policy was an unbending commitment to the ERM. Gone was even the rhetoric of nationalisation. Neil Kinnock's 3-year project to turn Labour into a safe, social, democratic party was complete. At last, his party was respectable and, according to all the opinion polls, electable. By 1990, the Thatcher government was in deep trouble. The poll tax was a disaster, coming as it did as the economy tipped into recession. The hated tax sparked mass protests, and in March, anger turned to violence during a demonstration in Trafalgar Square. Scenes like this seem to confirm the image of the Thatcher government as out of touch, extremist. At the mid-staffs by-election, the protest vote came to Labour. Kinnock's New Look party took the Tory seat with a massive 21% swing.
Because it reinforced the record of success that had come for months and months and months before that, then there were a lot of people in the party, myself included, that believed that we'd been building for the coming of the general election very successfully, gradual success that was then consolidated until we moved on to the next challenge, and we satisfied that challenge, passed that test, won again, and then kept on advancing. We were winning the trust of the British people. We were bringing new people to vote Labour and fulfilling, therefore, the objectives that I'd set for myself and the party 6 or 7 years before that.
Mid-Staffordshire seemed to prove that Kinnock's Labour Party could capture the safest Tory strongholds. But it was now that the Tory party made its move. Alarmed at what he saw as Mrs. Thatcher's anti-Europeanism, Geoffrey Howe resigned.
Sir Geoffrey Howe, time has come for others to consider their own response to the tragic conflict of loyalty with which I have myself wrestled for perhaps too long.
That speech triggered the long-awaited challenge by Michael Heseltine to Margaret Thatcher. Neil Kinnock, like the millions watching events unfold on television, was now just a spectator.
Good evening. Mrs. Thatcher came out of the first round of the Conservative leadership contest a winner, but only on points, 4 votes short, and she was hurt.
And it was the best possible result for us. A win in numerical terms for Mrs. Thatcher, but failure by 4 votes to get the majority plus 15% necessary to give her an outright win. So there was going to be another round, and I think everybody could understand my delight at the fact that she'd won, but not by quite enough. I watched as she came down the steps of the British Embassy in Paris, and her associates pushed reporters aside, and she made a statement about going on.
Where's the microphone?
It's here. This is the microphone.
Naturally, very pleased that I got more than half the parliamentary party, and disappointed that it's not quite enough to win on the first ballot. So I confirm it is my intention to let my name go forward for the second ballot.
And I said to my colleagues, she's blown it. She's completely blown it. That the arrogance, it will lead to her defeat. Because if she'd returned then, or even the next day, to London, and spoken to a few members of the Conservative Party, made it clear how critical it would be for the country, etc., etc., if she were to be defeated, then she would certainly have won on any future ballot. But instead of doing that, she really did strut.
Thank you very much.
I knew as I saw her coming down those steps that she'd completely thrown away the chance of remaining as leader of the Conservative Party.
Early this morning in Downing Street. Outside, it could have been any morning. Inside, at 7:30, a private conversation between Mrs. Thatcher and Peter Morrison, her parliamentary private secretary. I've slept on it. I'm going to resign.
On November the 22nd, Margaret Thatcher pulled out of the second ballot. The contest was now between Michael Heseltine, Douglas Hurd, and John Major. Kinnock, surprisingly, wanted Heseltine to win.
Michael Heseltine was feared by sections of the Labour Party, but I didn't share that fear. I thought that despite his combative qualities, he would implode. In any event, he would always alienate a substantial section of the Conservative Party and be remembered as the political assassin. One that I feared most was Douglas Hurd, because I believed that with his patrician attitude, he would not only be able to hold the Conservative Party together, but to have an appeal because of the contrast that he would develop with what had been Mrs. Thatcher's abrasive form of political address.
I believe very firmly in the 1990s that we will have a decade of the most remarkable opportunities.
John Major, I don't think anybody was too alarmed about him. I had the feeling, as I communicated to my colleagues, that because of his, pardon the phrase, greyness, because of his anonymity, here was a clear sheet, as it were. And any impression that the Conservative Party chose to give about him could be given.
At a stroke, Neil Kinnock's best chance of ever becoming Prime Minister had gone. With Margaret Thatcher went Kinnock's main hope of power. Overnight, Labour's huge opinion poll leads disappeared.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're leaving Downing Street for the last time after 11 and a half wonderful years, and we're very happy that we leave the United Kingdom in a very, very much better state than when we came here 11 and a half years ago.
If Mrs. Thatcher had remained as Conservative Party leader, we would have won the 1992 general election. The recognition of Mrs. Thatcher as the person who presided over two slumps, the result of her policies, and the antagonisms aroused by the poll tax, were sufficiently fresh in the public's memory to ensure that they would vote Labour, partly to punish the Conservative government under Mrs. Thatcher, and partly in recognition of the need for change. When Mrs. Thatcher went, I knew that the hill had all of a sudden become very much steeper.
Next week, Neil Kinnock tells how his political mission ended in failure and why. In Victory Denied, the final episode of Kinnock, the Inside Story.
Society, just me and now. That's Margaret Thatcher's society. Now is the time for change. Now is the time for labor.
I remember saying, that's it. It's not going to happen. I've just wasted 8 years of my life.
The Tories had played a masterstroke in replacing Margaret Thatcher with John Major. With Margaret Thatcher went Labour's huge opinion poll leads. Neil Kinnock seemed irrelevant to the crowning of a new premier.
At the end of this week, I believe that there is a smile on the face of the party that will mean we're fully united for the future.
For Labour and for Kinnock, the problem was how to land a punch on the new Prime Minister.
The one thing he wanted to be able to demonstrate and had to demonstrate was his single great quality, that he, John Major, was not Margaret Thatcher. And that's all he brought to the job, really. And I think that even he did acknowledge that. But it did mean that with the relief at the departure of Margaret Thatcher, there was a surge of public support for him as the Prime Minister.
Labour's best efforts to attack the new Prime Minister got nowhere.
We'd gone through his record, we had all the dreadful things he'd done as Chancellor, as Social Security Minister and so on. None of it worked. He was the original Teflon man. You know, we could tell a group of women voters that John Major had withdrawn income support from pregnant 16-year-old girls, and they would simply say, oh, I don't believe it. I don't believe it's much too nice ever to have done that. It would have been Thatcher who'd insisted on doing that. Typical Labour, of course. All they can ever do is say something nasty about people.
The end of the year or later before the ICC has concluded, but thus far it seems to go well. Are there any other further comments on community business?
Some in the party believe that facing moderate John Major, Kinnock's new model Labour Party would have to change gear.
At the time when John Major succeeded Mrs. Thatcher, Labour had been pursuing a strategy for a couple of years at any rate. A strategy of extreme caution, that we could expect to win the election because the Tories were profoundly unpopular, and that anything we essayed ourselves by way of a positive statement of policy was simply an unnecessary hostage to fortune. And indeed, we didn't really change, it seems to me, at that point, from the position that had been established, that we'd done the policy review, that all we were now doing was fine-tuning it, polishing it up. In other words, no debate, really, took place.
Kinnock didn't seem to recognise the world had changed. Opportunity Britain, launched in May 91, was just the old policy review repackaged. Shadow cabinet members were uneasy with the whole style Kinnock had set.
Oh, it became boring when the media people and the public relations people took over. They didn't want to talk about policy. They didn't want to be controversial. They didn't even want to re-emphasize our principal commitments of how we felt about full employment, how we felt about the socialist principle in the health service. We moved away from our political philosophy. We became bland, we became boring, we became aping the Tory government, as if we wanted to convince the electorate we're the alternative government, vote for us. But the electorate like to know what you stand for, and we moved away from that. We became boring and paid the price for it.
There was a constant effort that had to be made to get Labour to be perceived as respectable, acceptable, digestible, trustworthy. And that required a certain staidness of approach that didn't fit in with my temperament to a great extent, but I had disciplined myself to it, and I wanted the rest of the Labour movement to do the same. It was necessary to demonstrate that we were serious and capable. And you had to do that physically. People used to say to me from time to time, where's the excitement? And I would say to them, if it's excitement you want, well, a few circuses still open, and the theatres could do with many more customers. I'm not in the business of exciting you. It's something I would like to do one day. But in the meantime, excitement is something that parties that are stable and confident and united can provide. And we haven't yet reached the stage where we can be utterly confident on all those three grounds.
So, with few changes either to policy or to presentation, Neil Kinnock waited for the new Prime Minister to call a general election.
The period from John Major's election as leader of the Conservative Party and Prime Minister led to a period of phony war, which was extremely debilitating for all concerned. We had worked on the assumption that the general election would take place in June 1991, though there was some possibility that immediately after the Gulf War he would go to the country. We weren't in control of the election date, obviously, and so all we could do was to ensure that whenever it took place, we were in the strongest possible position. And that's why we campaigned extremely energetically over the whole of that period.
For Neil Kinnock, the deepening recession of 1991 was a double-edged sword. It ate into Conservative support, but at the same time, the deeper the recession became, the more Labour's commitment to raise child benefit and pensions seemed extravagant.
During an economic boom, those two commitments, to increase child benefit and to increase the pension, by no more than we had offered at the 1987 election, looked like the absolute minimum that we could get away with. They were the only firm public spending commitments. And I remember very senior politicians, John Smith for one, saying, you know, how terrific it was that we'd actually managed to nail down the party's propensity to spend money it didn't have to merely those two commitments.
But the deeper the slump became, the more difficult it was for the party to promise the tax increases to pay for these commitments. Kinnock's office, having abandoned so many policies, now considered dropping the two spending pledges as well.
There were discussions about whether or not the policy ought to be changed, but certainly from what I know of those conversations and the few I joined in, we just kept coming back to, look, if we ditch those commitments, you know, it's just going to look like Labour would sell its grandmother to win. It'll look as if we've got nothing left that we really believe in.
So Neil Kinnock was locked into the two spending pledges, and locked into raising the top rate of tax and lifting the £20,000 ceiling on national insurance contributions to pay for them. Kinnock now wanted John Smith and his economic team to mount a massive campaign on Labour's tax and spending plans to preempt the inevitable Tory attack.
The view of our office, right from the summer of 1991, was that we should be getting out and making our case as strongly as possible, as long as possible before the election. And it is the case that there was tension between our office and the Treasury team over that period on this issue.
Charles Clark, Kinnock's right-hand man, now admits that the Labour leader pressed John Smith in vain to get out and campaign on Labour's tax plans.
There were meetings of the Economic Subcommittee of the Shadow Cabinet, at which Neil made it quite clear that he wanted that course of action followed. And indeed, Neil himself went out and made a series of arguments on the general economic front, not only on taxation, in order to do it as strongly as possible. But at the end of the day, the fact is that not everybody agreed that that was the right approach, and I regret that that was the case.
there was a difficulty confronting everyone, including our Treasury team. And the big difficulty was that we knew that once there was no election in November, then the election was going to be after the budget of 1992. And of course, by that time, the revenue position, the real tax position that we faced in an election, could have been radically different from what existed in November 1991. So we could have been using up ammunition and exposing our flank months before a general election, and still not fighting on the ground that we would have to fight on in the general election. So there was a dilemma there. There's no doubt at all about that.
January 1992.
Labour didn't run a campaign on its tax plans.
Labour is so keen to get into power that they've been making lots of promises.
So the Tories did instead.
To pay for Labour's promises, the average taxpayer would end up being hit by an extra £1,000 tax bill.
Kinnock knew the Tory onslaught was effective.
Tax. Tax. And more tax.
So on January the 14th, 1992, at a private meal with journalists, Kinnock tried to blunt the tax attack.
I had a supper with six or eight lobby journalists. One of the journalists raised with me the question of our policy on national insurance increases. And I responded. Only a few of the journalists even heard the conversation taking place. And I said that it was possible, as we'd rehearsed in previous policy documents, for us to consider phasing in, if that were feasible, rather than introducing it all in one go. And this is something that was in our consideration for some time before, and so on and so forth.
If Kinnock wanted the national insurance changes to be phased in, he was quickly overruled by John Smith.
Well, we're quite clear we're going to make the change, but it is up to a Labour Chancellor to decide in his budget, in the light of the circumstances then prevailing, precisely how he goes about it.
Kinnock had failed to get his Treasury team either to campaign on the party's tax plans before the Tory offensive, or to soften the tax rises by promising to phase them in. His grip on his party, it seemed, didn't extend to his most senior colleagues.
My instinct was that we should seek to mitigate our policies, if that were at all possible, that we should seek to explain the policies, and to provide ourselves with the armory of countering the inevitable Tory attack and the inevitable Tory misrepresentation. For a mixture of reasons, many of them reasons of chronology, and reasons of political reality, that instinct couldn't be carried through.
For a time, Labour looked as if it had survived the tax assault. In the spring of 1992, every economic statistic seemed to condemn the Tory government. 3,000 people a day were losing their jobs in what had become the longest recession for 60 years. The long build-up to the election was finally over on Wednesday, March the 11th.
Good morning. I can now confirm to you that this morning I saw Her Majesty the Queen and sought her permission for a dissolution of Parliament and a general election on April the 9th.
As the campaign began, senior Tories were preparing for defeat.
The 1992 election was there for the taking by Labour. The government was unpopular. There was a deep economic recession. Unemployment was rising. It looked very bad indeed for the government. Very bad.
It looked terminal when, with only 10 days to go before polling day, Neil Kinnock got the news he had waited all his life to hear.
Labour well clear of the Tories in three new polls. Good evening. An opinion poll commissioned by News at 10 suggests tonight that Labour is set to win the general election with an overall majority of more than 20 seats.
According to these polls, Neil Kinnock was clearly heading for Downing Street. But those closest to the Labour leader were alarmed.
I was appalled by the opinion polls which came out 10 days before polling day, giving a substantial lead. Because for very, very many people, including some politicians, including many of the media, it made the election result a foregone conclusion that Labour would win. And so for the full 10 days between those polls coming out and polling day, the issue wasn't whether we wanted the Conservatives to continue in office, but whether we could trust Labour with office.
Neil Kinnock had set out to build a Labour Party that voters would trust with power. Now, and for the final 10 days of campaigning, his life's work would be tested.
Hang on. Hey, you gave Tommy pear with ice cream, but he wants peach.
But he wants peach.
No, but he wants fruit cocktail with yoghurt. Tommy wants peach, and he's got pear.
And he's got pear.
No, and he's got pineapple. It's amazing how he eats all that.
How he eats all that?
No, how he'll only eat apricot.
Will he?
Will he'll eat anything. Give him fruit cocktail!
If you haven't got fruit, you haven't got the full Del Monte.
In the Mirror this week, win a share of £100,000 with cash points.
I've won!
No, you haven't!
Ah! I have. You'll be surprised when you look in the mirror.
Just talking about sensitive skin makes me go all blotchy. It may look fresh and smooth now, but if I can't use a normal moisturiser, what then? These days, I don't let it irritate me.
Oil of Ulay Hypoallergenic. Pure, white and clinically proven to care for even highly sensitive skin. It continuously moisturises whilst avoiding irritation.
After all, young-looking skin doesn't grow on trees.
Oil of Ulay Hypoallergenic. Twice a day, because Ulay is young-looking skin.
Nice TV.
Pepper Army. It's a bit of an animal.
So now the world is brighter, and now I understand. My heart is so much lighter since you took it in your hands. You just have to ask me, and I could not say no.
In Italy, they say Cornetto has a heart of cream. Here it's the same. Wall's Cornetto. With real dairy ice cream. Rivers that taste of chocolate. All covered with the crunch of hazelnuts. Wall's Cornetto does.
I hear Goldblend are going to have a new campaign.
What?
Will the new Goldblend campaign feature Coffee Lover? An Italian?
Thank you.
An old friend? Or will it ring the changes?
What do you think the new Goldblend campaign will be?
So what do you think?
It'll be Golden Roasted.
Golden Roasted. Richer. Smoother. Nescafe Gold Blend.
It's coming soon, and one thing's for sure, it'll be in good taste.
Ah, Tony. Egg mayonnaise?
It's off, madam.
The bolognese?
That's off too, madam.
What about the gravy? The salad dressing? The red wine? All off. It's a different jacket.
No, a different detergent.
Persil Micro Liquid should always be on the menu. Because it has a double cleaning action, it can tackle more than one kind of stain. It combines an action on fat and an action on these other stains, all in one wash.
Now, what would you like?
The Dovasol, please.
Persil Micro Liquid tackles fat and a whole load more.
On the evening of Wednesday, April the 1st, the Labour Party staged the biggest political rally ever seen in Britain.
Please welcome Labour Chancellor of Exchequer, John Smith, Chief Secretary for the Treasury, Margaret Beckett.
There were aspects of the Sheffield rally with which I was very unhappy. For instance, I'd been vehemently against the idea of marching with the shadow cabinet from the back of the hall. And I'd made that very clear. Indeed, I'd expressly forbidden it. Because it appeared to me to be both triumphalist and clumsy. And what I said in private was, it was exactly the trick that Hitler used to play. I walked into the Sheffield Arena On the night of the rally, out of the light and into the darkness, my eyes got used to the gloom, and I realized to my horror that the shadow cabinet had been all put together in a kind of enclosure at the back of the hall, and that we were going to have to walk down through this magnificent rally with 10,000 people in a state of great enthusiasm. And it was too late to make any changes, so I had to get on with it. And we got to the stage, and I was enthused but calm. In fact, I turned around to colleagues saying, these steps are painted black, so be careful, be careful. So I got onto the stage and became conscious of the fact that there was this great screen and that this was going to be playing while I was speaking. But I thought, no, that's all wrong. And I turned round, and there was a huge roar of support. And for seconds, I don't know, you could turn it against 2 or 3 seconds, I completely let my defenses drop. I departed from all the self-discipline. And I responded to it as if it was a rock and roll rally.
Well, all right!
Kinnock himself now plays down the significance of Sheffield, but to some it was a defining moment.
So he practiced being a statesman for 8 years, and then he blew it all in about 10 seconds at Sheffield at that triumphalist rally in the 1992 election when he was shouting all wide, and I thought, well, you know, it's all been a waste of time. All the poses, all the attempt to appear to be a middle-of-the-road politician was all blown away.
If the triumphalism of Sheffield was an error of presentation, then Labour followed it with a policy error that was to dominate the last week of campaigning. Despite the 3-year policy review, the Labour Party was still split over proportional representation. Many in the party were now in favour, including the leader himself, but many still opposed, including Kinnock's deputy, Roy Hattersley. The compromise was the Plant Committee, set up to examine electoral systems. Despite the lack of clear policy on proportional representation, Kinnock now used it in a clumsy bid for the Lib Dem vote.
...of Labour government, then the Plant Committee and its work would gain an extra authority, and we envisage extending its membership when we move into government and offering participation in the work of that committee to people from other political parties.
We knew that people were worried about the possibility of a Labour government because we knew they still didn't trust us. And it was therefore important to try and indicate in various ways, and PR was just a rather small one, that we were willing to work with other people. In particular, we were willing to work with the Liberals on the question of constitutional reform.
If it was meant as a signal of reassurance, then it was botched. To the press and to the watching world, it was Kinnock opening negotiations with the Liberals in anticipation of a hung parliament.
I think deciding to focus on constitutional issues on so-called Democracy Day was a great mistake of the campaign. I was always against it. But it was thought that because Charter 88 had designated this Democracy Day, we somehow had to respond. Quite illogical, but that was the majority opinion. The disaster was responding in the way we did. We gave the impression that we might want PR. We gave the impression that we were toying with the idea of being part of a coalition.
Electoral pacts and hung parliaments dominated the final days of the campaign. The picture of Kinnock as an opportunist grubbing for votes struck a popular chord. And fearing a split in his own party, he didn't dare reveal that he now favoured PR. When pressed for his own views, he became wordy, evasive and shifty.
Mr. Dunn, your question, if you will.
I'm in favour of proportional representation. I want to know where you personally stand on the subject.
Yes. Well, I'd be delighted to be able to tell you at this juncture. Oh, I'd be delighted to. I realised that I was being bowled a difficult ball. And as he was speaking, I thought I will simply say Our policy and my intention is to open the door so that others can be involved.
As you may know,
yes
Mr.
Yes or no, isn't it?
Yes,
whether
sure.
you agree with it or you don't agree
well,
with
quite.
It.
Well, quite. No, it isn't quite as simple as that, not sitting where I sit. Can I just say...
I'll be glad to explain...
And of course, that is a pretty daft thing for a politician, especially in those circumstances, to do. But it was the nearest thing that I could get to an honest answer at that stage.
They want to know where you stand on Tehran.
That is what we will do. And I find it extraordinary that the current government believes that our system is incapable of improvement. I refuse to take that view.
Despite his 8 years as Labour leader, Kinnock had never won the respect or the trust of the electorate as a whole.
Our time is up. Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Kinnock.
He was now an easy target for his political opponents.
Can we trust Neil Kinnock? When he was a leader of the hard left, he wanted to nationalise everything in sight. Once he was a leading light of CND and wanted to ban the bomb. Now he says he's dropped CND. The more he changes, the more people think Neil Kinnock can't be trusted. They can't trust a man who would change any principle, abandon any policy, say anything to get elected.
The Kinnock factor, it seemed, was now one of the biggest obstacles to voting Labour. A painful irony for the man whose life's work had been to try to make Labour electable.
He wasn't a vote winner in the last election. I don't think there's any doubt about that, and I think that had been increasingly shown in the polls 12 months beforehand. There were some early discussions when we asked in the Shadow Cabinet about what the poll ratings were for Neil, and it was clear that people were not happy with it. But then we were into the final stages, and Neil was not, at the end of the day, as big a vote winner that everybody thought and hoped he would be, and in fact deter people voting Labour.
I think perhaps the Tory propaganda that he'd changed his position only to win votes got over a little bit to the public. But I think the real problem was that his physical appearance was not that of a prime minister, and it particularly didn't appeal to the women voters.
He didn't have the kind of gravitas that people look for in prime ministers. Neil is very much a working class man, a very ordinary working class decent man, a values man with a Welsh accent, and the British people just don't look on that kind of person as a potential prime minister.
In the final days of the campaign, Neil Kinnock began to sense he would never make it to power. Whether it was the tabloid attacks or the PR confusion, the triumphalism of Sheffield, or just the approach of polling day, something had triggered a swing away from Labour, a swing away from Neil Kinnock.
At the weekend before the election, for no reason I could put my finger on, just instinct, I suppose, after, I don't know, 35 years in politics, I felt uneasy. I felt there was movement going on, and I didn't think it was towards us. Then on the Monday night before the election, Dennis had been out campaigning in East Anglia, and I'd been elsewhere, and we got home very, very late. And we were having a cup of tea just to sort of wind down a little. And I was in the middle of saying something, and Glenys looked straight in the eye and said, you don't think we're going to win, do you? And I said, no, I don't. You don't either. And she said, well, I became certain today when in the streets people were really kind, welcoming, but it wasn't in their eyes. There was a slightly unreal feeling about polling day, April the 9th, 1992. Everybody that I met was so confident that we were going to win. And I knew deep down inside that it was unlikely to happen, and I had to maintain this general confidence and ebullience throughout, because there was absolutely no point in depressing or demoralizing anybody else. And in any case, perhaps I was wrong, but I didn't think I was. The kids, my children, had come down for the evening. We had a chat and a drink. And that's when I told Steve and Rachel that I didn't think we were going to make it. And they, to say the least, were dismayed. But typically, as they had so many times over the years, they sort of gave me support. They said, okay, we'll see it through. And we did. So by the time we get to Thursday night and the first results started to come in, I'd already said to the people closest to me that I was certain that we weren't going to win.
Christopher John Mullin.
Labour.
29,300.
I was sitting in an armchair in front of the television with Glenys next to me. And the Sunderland South result came. And I could see Chris Mullin's face. He was our candidate, somebody I'd known for a very long time. And there was no great delight on his face.
Green Party.
I remember saying, that's it. It's not going to happen. I've just wasted 8 years of my life. And I got up and got myself a drink. And other people in the room, I think, were fairly dumbstruck. And then, because they were close to me, he thought, well, that's the kind of thing he would say. You know, he's hardly going to be euphoric about a 2% swing or whatever it was. But a lot of them knew as well that if we hadn't managed to produce a real force for ourselves in a seat like Sunderland, it wasn't going to happen elsewhere.
Here is the national swing turning just that number of Conservative MPs from blue to red, if that were typical. That's the Basildon swing, that's the national swing.
Conservatives holding on to Bury North. A hopeless case for Labour that the Conservatives...
The results, which really were depressing, were the ones that came in from the North West, West Midlands and so on, of seats that we needed to win, where we simply weren't cutting it. And I remember we left the place where we were staying to go down to Neil's own camp, that it would have been about 1:30 in the morning. And I was talking to Glenys about it, and you know, I said that I thought we were gone at that point. And we were indeed gone. There was an overall majority of the Conservatives.
As Neil Kinnock arrived at his count in the early hours of the morning, he knew already that his party was running into trouble, and his leadership with it.
Kinnock! Neil!
It was a disastrous night for Neil Kinnock and for his party. The swing to Labour was a mere 2%. Despite their record of recession and poll tax, the Tories had won yet another safe majority for another 5 years.
I was deeply, deeply downcast by defeat. But I wasn't going to show that to anybody. And I certainly wasn't going to add a slab of despair to the burdens that Glenys and my family were already carrying.
We've made gains from Plymouth to Cambridge, through London and several places in the southeast, into the Midlands. The battle is not yet over, and it is a battle. But I take this opportunity of dedicating myself to the service of my constituents and in any capacity whatsoever to the people of my country.
We left the Leisure Centre and headed straight back to London. Not in triumph, as we'd all hoped, but in my view, almost in secrecy and in defeat. And what I then had to do in the back of the car was to scribble out some words so that I could make a cogent statement at Walworth Road. So Glenys and I talked a bit, and I scribbled a bit. So that by the time we got to Walworth Road, all I had to do was to give to my people who were upstairs the piece that I'd written, and they typed it up. And as soon as we were ready, then I went downstairs to end it all.
We will work to ensure that the day will come when, with the Labour government, the country will get better in its spirit, in its soul, in its fortune.
As dawn arrived on the morning of April the 10th, the scale of Labour's defeat became clear. The Tories, in the teeth of the longest recession since the 1930s, had won again.
their share of the vote, 42%, was unchanged on 1987. Kinnock had cut the Tory majority to 21, but Labour's 35% of the vote was still the third worst result in the party's post-war history.
We won tonight a magnificent victory. A victory that many people thought was beyond our grasp, but one which the Conservative Party always believed was there for the taking.
The final 1992 result was a failure of our project. We'd succeeded in many ways. We'd reformed the party in many ways. We'd changed the policies of the party in many ways. We'd shown the most effective campaigning of any party in recent times in Britain. But at the end of the day, we'd failed in our key project, which was to convince people that we could be trusted with their votes. The core fact was that when it came to it, people did not trust Labour to govern.
Oh, I considered myself then, and I consider myself now, to be a personal political failure. How could it be otherwise? I've led the party, and we've been defeated twice. That's hardly a definition of success. I can find substantial evidence of gains, of advances, of successes. But overall, if you don't win, you can't regard the record as a successful one. I certainly don't. And I think that I would be giving myself a false impression, deluding myself, if I regarded that record as anything other than one of partial improvement.
On April the 13th, 1992, Neil Kinnock announced that he would resign. He had nothing more to give.
I will not be seeking re-election as the leader of the Labour Party. I did think that it would be possible this time to succeed in achieving change. Success will therefore have to wait, but it will come, and I will work for it. Thank you very much for your attention.
I therefore declare that John Smith is elected the leader of...
On July the 18th, 1992, Neil Kinnock stood down, and John Smith took on the Labour leadership. Neil Kinnock is now a backbencher again. He's an active MP, nothing more, nothing less.
It's a year since I stopped being the leader of the Labour Party, 15 months since we lost the election. And in the course of the last year or so, I've had some enjoyable times and some very entertaining times. I've enjoyed also doing my job as a constituency member of Parliament. I firmly intend to run for election in Islwyn at the next general election. And I'm happy to do that.
Like any backbench MP, Neil Kinnock now attends to constituency duties, the surgeries, the prize givings, the town band concerts.
The best youth band in the whole continent of Europe, the Tredegar Youth Band.
The future is uncertain for Neil Kinnock.
I think it highly unlikely that I would in the foreseeable future run for the shadow cabinet. And the foreseeable future means before the next general election.
But in the longer term, Neil Kinnock still hopes to be a member of a Labour government.
I'd like to serve, and I think that I've got one or two skills that could be usefully employed. So I want us to get a Labour government, and I want it to be a good Labour government, and anything that I could do to enhance that prospect, I happily will do.
Until that day, Neil Kinnock will remain a backbench Labour MP. A man who once led his party. A man whom history will judge. Some of his former opponents, perhaps predictably, are scathing.
Mr. Kinnock's principal achievement in British politics was to make sure that the Conservatives won in 87 and 92. That was a vitally important service to the British nation.
And within the Labour Party, too, there are those for whom Kinnock was a failure.
I think the judgment of history will be very full. It'll be quite simply that Neil Kinnock wasn't up to the job of running the Labour Party and certainly running the country. He left the Labour Party in absolute shambles, virtually the lowest membership we've ever had, many parties barely functioning, an incoherent mishmash of policies which turned our back on the essential part of the Labour soul. And you've got to remember, a party is something more than just all its component parts, a set of ideals and beliefs. At the end of the day, we ended up like some sort of advertising agency. It's a damning indictment.
To some on the left, Kinnock was a man who abandoned his principles and built a party that stood for nothing.
Neil Kinnock gave everything to the Labour Party, and his family paid a price that they shouldn't have done. But I think at the end of the day, some of the judgments about party organisation and the way he did it created a great deal of division and bitterness. And I think the judgments about political policies were such that you moved away from principles of policy and emphasized more presentation. We became boring. We didn't excite the electorate. We didn't seem as if we stood for anything. We all pay a price for that. We're all responsible for that. But Neil must take his share also. And we lost the election.
Remember how you felt on that dreadful morning of June the 10th. Just remember how you felt then and think to yourself, June the 9th, 1983, never, ever again will we experience that.
He moved the party towards a position in which we clearly were seen as eminently electable. The only tragedy is that at the same time, on that course, we lost our soul. We lost that driving sense of purpose, of direction, of crusade, without which the Labour Party is nothing.
No sisterhood, no brotherhood, no neighbourhood, no honouring other people's mothers and fathers. No such thing as society, just me and now. That's Margaret Thatcher's society.
Others believe that Neil Kinnock saved the Labour Party and gave it the chance one day to form a government again.
Had we not had the Kinnock years, had Neil Kinnock not done the things which he did, then the Labour Party would never have been elected again. It may be that by turning his back on some of his old principles and by fighting so bravely within the Labour Party, he made it impossible for him ever to become Prime Minister. But by making it impossible for him to be Prime Minister, he's made it possible for future Labour leaders to go into Downing Street.
Comrades, it seems it matters not whether you won or lost, but how you played the game. We can't take that into
account. Truth was, he judged that it was from left of centre he could best lever the Labour Party towards the centre stage. And he did that, and he did it effectively, and he did it certainly more successfully than Hugh Gaitskell had been able to secure that task. And that's what I think will be remembered. And of course, he made the Labour Party more electable, but it didn't get elected.
Now is the time to make our country safer, cleaner, more secure. Now is the time for Britain to pull together. Now is the time for change.
And certainly by the time one got to the 92 election, I thought he'd become a considerable political figure with a lot of flair, certain imagination and flair. I think he might have made quite a considerable Prime Minister. I was sorry he did not have the chance after 1992.
Me and millions of others of my generation got all their chances from this movement.
Well, I think he gave all his heart and soul to making the Labour Party a more effective body for winning an election and establishing a decent Labour government in power for a long period. I think we're going to get it, and when we get it, we'll owe a great deal to Neil Kinnock for having done it.
Neil Kinnock
is the most courageous politician I've ever known. Immense courage and immense loyalty to those who are prepared to give it to him. But there's only one thing that could be written on his gravestone, and that is Neil Kinnock, the man who saved the Labour Party.
I believe that Labour under John Smith will win the next general election. I believe that Labour will form the government. I want it because it will demonstrate that all the things that were done between 1983 and 1992, the changes that were made, the differences that were embraced, weren't a waste of time. That they really did provide a foundation of strength for the Labour Party. I hope that I've played my part and can play a future part in trying to ensure that Britain gets a Labour government. Because as I said, on the night of our election defeat, Britain deserves better.
I owe this party every life chance I've had from the time I was a child. Be sure that you can convincingly justify the way that you vote. In the street, at work, wherever you go, justify it there! Justify it there! You can't play politics with people's jobs and with people's...